by the way, if you have any questions on any of it, even if it's just necessary and sufficient in general, or other things, I think you should feel free to PM me on 7Sage. I'm always happy to help. I think we'll be fine today with just talking about a little bit about the difference between necessary versus sufficient assumptions. Before we do that, let me just jump in real quick to... Let's just talk about a good approach to LR in general. Everyone's got a different idea. My belief, and I actually talked about this in a recent post, is look at the question itself before you go to the stimulus. And I'm not going to make an assumption here that everyone knows the difference between question versus stimulus. So, right, the question is that blurb, if you see my cursor. I don't know if everyone can see my cursor right over here. Right, that's when I say the question, I'm talking about this right here. And then the stimulus is that big blurb that's usually about a paragraph right in the very beginning of your LR question. I hope everyone's okay on that. If you're unsure, then send me a message through GoToMeeting and I'll clarify. But I think you all get the difference. Look, there are two schools of thought. Some people say, hey, read the blurb first, read the stimulus first, then go to the question. Others like me say, no, read the question first, then go to the stimulus. I think either's fine. I have a strong preference for reading the question first for two reasons. One, you should know question types. And look, we're doing a question type now, necessary assumptions. Another question type is sufficient assumptions, as I'm sure you know. But if you know your question type and you can identify it from the very beginning, two things happen. One, you can have a strategy for it, which, by the way, is the purpose of our meeting today. And two, you can then read this stimulus differently for your question type in a more focused, strategic way than you would had you just gone right into the stimulus. I'm going to read for a necessary assumption, probably in a much more strategically different way than I would, say, for a must-be-true question or a most strongly supported question or a method of reasoning question. So that's why I think it's worthwhile to read the question first before you get into the stimulus. Hope everyone's with me. If you're not, send me a message. If you are, you could just sort of leave it blank. That's where I like to begin. So then the next question is, well, how do we know that we've got a necessary assumption type? And this is where we're going to talk about the difference between sufficient versus necessary assumptions. And we're just going to do it for our purposes on a superficial level because I don't want to bog you down. So here's what it comes down to. Like, they're all going to have the word assumption in them, but there are going to be some keywords that are different for necessary assumptions versus sufficient assumptions. Let's just take a look at number 9 real quick. Which one of the following is an assumption on which the naturalist's arguments depends? So obviously it's got the word assumption, but then it's got the word depends. That is going to tell you. Just take my word on this. We can get into the intricacies of it later. But right now, just for the purposes of being able to identify that you're dealing with a necessary assumption, I want you to know you're going to have keywords. You're definitely going to have assumption, right? And you're going, actually, I'll tell you what, I'm going to send this to everyone. You're going to have assumption. And then there are like about four different... The reason I'm saying keywords is because you want to, as JY would say, you want to kind of be like a machine where you're just like, oh, this is an assumption question. Great. What type of assumption question? Oh, they say the word depends. It's a necessary assumption. Great. That way you can move efficiently and effectively through these questions, right? So you're going to see the word assumption plus, bear with me one moment.
Jimmy, are you typing something that we should be seeing?
I am typing something. I just sent it.
Oh, I see. I see on the comments. Okay, great. I was worried that it was something. Cool.
Thanks, Dave. I just sent it right now. I apologize for the delay. And let me also apologize up front. We decided to do this 2 days ago. I would have prepared something outright a little bit more. I don't have that many notes to give you, so if you
Right.
want to just copy and paste this into your notes, it'd just be a few things here and there.
Yeah, I mean,
I thought
I
it
should
maybe.
make a note. I think people knew that we had a different workshop planned for today. It was going to be just flaws and assumptions on a more fundamental basic level, and I kind of wanted to do it that way. So before we got into LR questions, but the tutor that was scheduled to do that, she was sick all this week, and she really couldn't prepare, and she really wasn't feeling up to it. So we pushed her back 2 weeks, and Jimmy was like very happy to fill that gap. But yeah, he just didn't, he kind of did as much as he could. But yeah, so there isn't going to have to necessarily we shouldn't have that same expectation in terms of the preparation. That being said, preparation, that's always nice, but really what we want is Jimmy's process, how Jimmy thinks about these things, because clearly it's working for him. So that's yeah, Jimmy, you don't have to apologize to us. You're doing a great job. Just keep doing what you're doing and show us how you do this.
Well, thanks. Again, if we do any other ones in the future, I'll probably have something to lay out a little more prepared. But I think for our purposes now, this chat should be fine. I'm just sending you. You're gonna look for the word assumption, obviously, and then we've got keywords. So I'll tell you what. To keep, I would like to keep everyone engaged as much as possible. I know this stuff could be kind of dry. So how about this? I think everyone's got the chat function where you could send out stuff to all. So why don't you throw out keywords like what else do you need besides assumption? Required. Excellent, Lauren. Required. What else? You have about four of them. Mitzi, depends. Excellent. I hope I'm pronouncing your screen name right, Mitzi. And Amy, right? I hope I'm pronouncing that right. Depends. Cool. All right, cool. Thank you, Lauren. Thank you, Mitzi. So we've got depends, right? We've got required. What else? Necessary. Excellent, Jamal. Excellent. And then I think we got one X that Sam, you got it. Perfect. Relies. Exactly. Implies. No, I don't think so. I think that one. So again, and it's okay, Lauren. I'm glad. I want you to guess. I think that's a good thing. I want to keep you engaged. Like that's an important part of this process. It implies. I don't. I mean, unless if it's being used, that could be like
I think it's
that.
because it implies sort of
That could be like
we think
synonym
of
for assumption.
like a condition. It introduces it couldn't because X implies Y, but I don't think it's necessarily an assumption that
Yeah.
we can make.
And that's not a bad thing. I'm glad you guessed it. The only thing I think it might work at, right, like is the word assumption is probably going to be there. Maybe they'll have like implication instead of assumption, but it usually says assumption. The only way I can see implies maybe working is if it's for if it's is if it's a synonym for assumption. But I would say 9 times out of 10 they're going to say assumption. So you need those two words. You need assumption and then one of those other words we threw out there. So the four potential words. The four other words are relies, and it could be rely, depends, requires, necessary, or maybe needs. I don't think needs will be there, but some form of these four words I just sent out, right? So you're going to see assumption, and then relies, depends, requires, necessary. And again, this is all on a superficial level. Like, the reason that's important is because you don't want to have to reread. This is really important, actually. For I would say this for any of these LR questions, and just about any, even reading comp. You don't want to have to like sort of discover the meaning of these question types every time you do them. And by that I mean whether it's a necessary assumption question or a must be true question or a method of reasoning or a flaw. Either way, you don't have to be like you don't want to read it like. Which of the following is an assumption on which the naturalist's argument depends? Which of the following is an assumption depends? Like you don't want to be doing that. You don't have to figure it out. You want to be at the point where you're seeing this, you see, oh, okay, they got the word assumption, they got the word depends. That's one of my four. Great. That means that this is a necessary assumption question. I'm gonna go right to my strategy for necessary assumption questions. Does that make sense, everybody? And by the way, I wouldn't feel free to message. Okay, cool. Feel free to message if it doesn't make sense. You know, I want your feedback. Even if you want to send it to just me, that's fine. And we could keep it anonymous, and I could clarify things, or if necessary, I can get back to you later on PM or something. But yeah, like I think it's I if you really want to embrace the lessons of Seven Sage, and I say this about every question type, you don't want to sort of rediscover these questions as you go through them, because they're all essentially a template. You really want to be like, oh, necessary assumption question, I'm going to my strategy. Oh, method of reasoning question, I'm going to my strategy. You want to be at that point, and if you're not, spend some time to master question types. And again, it really just comes down to seeing the keywords that trigger what question type it is. So that, like, as JY says, you're like a machine. You want to make this a habit. Dave and I were talking before, and he mentioned habits, and I was so happy to hear that, because that's what you want this to be. You want it to be a habit. People talk about, oh, I need to increase my speed. I mean, yeah, time is a factor for all of us, but I think the most effective way you could do that is focus on making a lot of this like automated, making it a habit. So again, without diverging too much, let's get back to necessary assumptions. So okay, that's how we identify that it is a necessary assumption question. The only other issue is sometimes people might confuse it with a sufficient assumption question. We're not going to get into sufficient assumption questions today, but just for the purpose of avoiding it, what are the key, I mean, I think there's maybe one key word for sufficient assumptions. Maybe two, but I think you'd be fine in just looking for these four words that we mentioned for necessary assumptions. But so for example, can anyone guess as to like how a sufficient assumption might be worded just for the purpose of differentiation? If you want to, obviously you'd see assumption. If Amy, excellent. If Lily, excellent. If yep. I would say, you know, I've worked with a lot of students on these, and I would say that the only time you really know that it's a sufficient assumption is if it says the word if. That's a good keyword. And Sam, I see where you're yeah. I think that's fair. They might do it in some way that doesn't lend itself to a keyword, where they, as Sam says, they essentially ask you to validate the conclusion or draws logically. Excellent. I hope I'm pronouncing Riju or Rihu. My last name is hard to pronounce, so I hope you'll forgive me. I can empathize. But that's a great point. Like if they either you see the keyword if, or they're going to ask you to validate the conclusion or draw it logically. Okay, cool. I'm glad I got it right. Thank you. So yeah, I think you'll be good on just knowing those four for necessary assumption. And then again, if or saying follows logically or the conclusion or good. So it seems like most of you know the difference. Again, I think you'll be fine if you just know those four basic keywords: necessary, depends, relies, requires, with the word assumption, and that'll help you identify that it's a necessary assumption question. Okay, cool. So we're a good portion of the way there, because honestly, just knowing question type and making it automatic is important. Now it comes down to strategy. Before we get into strategy, I want to talk a little bit about the concept of it. And this concept is a bit more complex than most. I've seen it explained a bunch of times, and it took me some time to get it. So don't feel bad if you're not getting it at first. But I want to get into the pure concept of it without the practical stuff. So let's just talk about it in concept only. So let's see. You know what? Let me do this. I'm wondering if I should. I'll give you an example of how I like to think about it. So I like to think about necessary assumptions as sort of like the floor. You ever hear that phrase? You guys ever hear that phrase, low floor, high floor, low ceiling? Like it's the bare minimum of what you have to have to make something work. Does that make sense at all? And if it doesn't, let me know. If you don't want to speak up or message me, that's fine. But cool. All right, I got some feedback. So cool. Yeah, it's the bare minimum. You need this to happen. And that okay, you even if you get that in concept, the way these questions play out can be kind of weird and honestly kind of annoying. And I'll explain what I mean by that in a second. Let me do that right now. So, yeah, Amy, good point. Like, weakest link, right? You need that to happen. You need that to happen. And if it's not happening, the assumption, if that assumption is not there, the argument falls apart, right? So I think we can get that. But then when you see a lot of these in practice, it can be kind of weird and head-scratching and again, annoying. And what I mean by annoying is, I think this is like kind of this can almost be the stereotype of what people, I used to hate like the idea of like this annoying, like overanalyzing logic stuff and getting down to the minutia. It's like, I remember thinking, geez, who cares? Like it almost sounded like people were just trying to, I don't know. I'll give an example of what I mean. It's like your annoying like friend who's always trying to say, hey, I'm smarter than you, look. And they try to give you a riddle, and it's really corny, and yeah, it might follow logically, but it's really annoying. And by that I mean this. So someone says to you, okay, I'm going to pick you up in 30, I'm going to drive over to your house, and I'm going to pick you up in 30 minutes. Then you want to figure out what are the necessary assumptions for that to be true, right? Like, there's some things that just, if your friend is going to pick you up in 30 minutes, they're going to drive over and pick you up in 30 minutes, for that to be true, what are the necessary assumptions? Again, we're talking about the floor assumptions. These are things that have to be true. And you could throw out ideas. I'll throw out a few. Be like, all right, well, my friend's going to, they need a vehicle, right? There's transportation, right? They could drive. They can see, right? See, there you go. Let's think about the ones you guys have thrown out. I think you guys threw out a lot of necessary ones, right? Like, yeah, right? It's low floor. Stephanie, I like what you said there. There's a way to get to your house. Sam, shouldn't live any further than 30 minutes away, assuming they're following the speed limit. Excellent. I'm wondering if you guys even need this this webinar. You're doing so great. Let's talk about the common denominator that make these answers right. They're like the low floor. They're like the bare minimum. What has to be true? Right, like, I could see someone being like, well, he's got to have gas. And I like that, Stephanie. If you had, like, an annoying friend that was giving you this as a riddle, and they're like, well, look, he's got to have gas. Like, if he doesn't have gas, he can't start the car, right? I mean, those are one of those things where you're going to roll your eyes, and you're like, yeah, of course, he's got to have gas. Well, a driver's license, he doesn't necessarily have to have a driver's license. Or at least he knows how to drive, Amy. But good point. I think normally that would be fair. But yeah, like let me use the goofy example I had. His car has enough gas or fuel. We'll say fuel because who knows, maybe it runs on electric his car has enough power, right? Like the reason that an answer like that is true but annoying, as I would say, is because you'd always assume this, like, well, hello, of course he's got to have fuel, you know. And it's like something like if you ever had one of those annoying friends, it's like, it's almost like a goofy riddle where they're trying to one up you, and they're like, well, he's got to have fuel, like, yeah, he's got to have fuel, because if he doesn't have fuel, there's no way he's gonna pick you up or she's gonna pick you up. Or let's see, I like a lot of these examples. There's a way to get to your house, right? Like that has to be true. That has to be true. These are things. Necessary assumptions are things we almost take for granted. It's, you know, they have to be true. They can see, right? That's a good one. They can see. Like, that's a great, you know, like, the person has to see if they're going to drive. So, again, like, these are things, when you first start doing problems like these answers are annoying. Like, it's like, you'll go and you'll pick something and you could be like, well, shoot, I get this. You know, you're right. A blind Stephanie, you're if that is Steph Arizona, I'm assuming it's Stephanie. You're right. A blind person could pick you up with Uber, right? And I get it. You know, these are things that we would like either overlook or take for granted, and that's what when you first start doing necessary assumptions, Like, again, these questions, you could be like, when you start doing these, you might be like, oh my God, of course. I mean, of course he has to be able to drive. Of course there has to be a way to get to your house. But though, when you're like, oh, of course, those have to be the answers. So that's what necessary assumption means in concept. And basically, like, if that isn't what we really want to mean in concept is, if these things aren't true, if these necessary assumptions aren't true, then it can't happen. It's necessary. It is required. If they're not true, it doesn't happen. And that leads us to our litmus test, or our strategy for getting the correct answer. And by that, this is the rule you want to use is, I'm going to write this out. Go down your answer choices and negate them. Pretend they're false. The one that makes the argument fall apart is the one that the answer choice where if you make the argument fall apart, that's the if you negate it. Let me explain this a little better. If you negate the answer choices, the one answer choice that, when negated, makes the argument fall apart, that's the correct answer. I'm going to write that out and send it to you in a more in a little better way of explaining it, in a little more concise way. But before I do that, let me see. Stephanie has a question. Wouldn't being able to see be a sufficient assumption? You know, here's an interesting thing, Stephanie. Once in a while, and this is when it gets really tricky and some of the harder necessary assumptions, some of the answers might be both sufficient and necessary, believe it or not. But the point is, for this question, it has to be necessary. Now, let me think about that. I don't know if being able to see is sufficient. Because, I mean, look, I'm able to see, great. I mean, that doesn't necessarily mean I'm actually going to get to your house in 30 minutes. I could be able to see and always run behind because I'm a dilly-dallier, you know. But once in a while, you can have ones that are both. Let me just say this, Stephanie. Once in a while, just because your answer choice might also fit sufficient assumption, doesn't mean that it's not necessary assumption, if that helps. But here's the thing, Stephanie. If you follow the rule I'm saying, there's only going to be one answer choice where if you negate it, the argument falls apart. And that's going to be a correct one. If it happens to fit as a sufficient assumption, so what? The point is, it's a necessary assumption, because if you negate it, then the argument falls apart. And we're gonna try this on a few problems, and you'll see what I mean. But at least in concept now, do you get my point, Stephanie? Sam, good question. Good question. And by the way, negating them takes a little bit of skill. But it's not that bad. You basically want to, for all practical purposes, you want to say, okay, would this still be true if, would the argument still hold true if this assumption were false? And we'll see what that means in practice. Let me also say this. I'm a big believer in, the idea of predicting what the answer choice is or could be before I get down, what the answer is or could be before I get down to the answer choices. Even for something like this that relies heavily on looking at the answer choices, I still think it's worth it for you to make a prediction of what we're looking for. We'll see this in practice. Let me look at what Amy says. You can also just check to see if it must be true for round one. I mean, that's another way to think about it. If it must be true, right? Like, if this has to be true, because if it's not true, I mean, it's sort of the same thing, right? Like, if these answer choices must be true, because if it's not true, then the argument falls apart, then you're in trouble. But let me make this suggestion. How about we hold off a little bit on some of our worries about negating them until we get to our example? Because I think that this might take care of it. I'm not going to lie. I think sometimes it – I'm not going to say this is going to be a cure-all for any concerns you guys have. But I think for the most part, as you do more of these, you'll get to acquire and a skill for negating them. And I don't think it's as bad as it seems. I think it really just comes down to, like, when I say negate, let me say this. I think this might help. When I say negate, I practically try to picture an example of what the argument would be like if the answer choice was false, right? So if they say, oh, all dogs are blue, I'll picture a red dog. I don't know. And see if – I know it sounds silly. I'm just throwing it out there. And see if that makes the argument fall apart. But let's – we'll put this into practice as we do it. But I want to clarify the rule, and then we'll jump into an example. So actually, I'll tell you what. Can somebody volunteer a concise – this is the key word – a concise way of phrasing this rule, so, and send it out. So, and then we'll see which one works. Maybe we'll edit it a little bit. But basically, we want to say, you know, when you negate and the answer choices, the argument falls apart. That's the one where if you negate it, the argument falls apart. That's the correct answer choice. Does anyone want to take a hand at sort of phrasing that in a more concise way than I've said it? I'll give you some time to type if anyone wants to volunteer. Ooh, I like what you wrote there, Sam. The answer choice that when negated destroys the argument is the correct answer choice. Cool. Cool. What are you sorry about, Lauren? Nothing to be sorry about. Okay. Let me do this. Don't worry about that, Lauren. I've made mistakes. I just made one now. I'm gonna send one out myself. Let me see what I got here from Riju. Again, I forgot how to pronounce it. I hope I'm not mispronouncing it. I think I got it right. If the assumption is negated, it wrecks the argument. The assumption is required and necessary to hold the argument. Okay, cool. Well, I'll tell you what, guys. There are three of us that threw out examples of how to phrase this. If you like Sam's, pick Sam's. If you like Riju's, pick Riju's. If you like mine, pick mine. But either way, whatever is phrased in a way that kind of gels for you, take it, put it in your notes, and make that your rule. And if you want to edit any of them, so again, I'm a big believer in what works for you. If you want to edit any of them so they gel with you better, feel free to. But that's the gist of how all of this works. So again, look, if I'm doing this, right, I just go, I say, okay, it's a necessary assumption type. Now, I'm going to read my stimulus, and then I want to make predictions, and we'll do this together, about, like, hey, what are things that must be true? Okay, so I have an idea. And then when I go to my answer choice, I say, okay, well, let me take a look and see, like, the surefire way to get this right. Let me take a look and go down the list of answer choices. Some of them, again, I think you guys were kind of saying maybe you could just take a glance at and you could see it's not important. But I think it's good for all of them, really, to go through and just negate them real quick, picture, you know, an example of it not being true and see how that fares in the argument. And then one other concept I want to jump back to a little bit. When we are looking at the stimulus, we're looking at the argument. And by the way, this is a little tip for you if you're not aware of this. A good way to approach just about every one of these stimuluses to understand the argument is separate out the premises from the conclusion. Or at the very least, the best way to do this is find the conclusion. And we don't have too much time to get into how to find the conclusion, but I'll jump into it a little bit. But like, the reason this is helpful now is because the only way that you could figure out if it destroys the argument is if negating it makes the conclusion not true or not valid, or it doesn't, like, unable to happen. So you need to know the conclusion to understand the argument. So you need to separate the conclusion from all the premises or sort of intermediate conclusions. You need to know the ultimate conclusion. And a good way to think of it, I mean, I don't want to get too much into this. Of course, I'm happy to answer any questions on it if they come up. I just don't want to sidetrack us. But a good way to think of finding the conclusion is obviously keywords. I imagine, I don't want to assume, but I imagine a lot of you have like come to the point where you can understand, you know, what the keywords are that tells you this is the conclusion. But another way to think of it is, if you've read through the argument and you have an understanding of it, the conclusion, I mean the ultimate conclusion, is one where it doesn't support any other part of the argument. The ultimate conclusion of the argument, the final full conclusion, is one where everything else in the argument, all the other premises, support that conclusion. That is the umbrella argument. It does not support anything else in the argument. Does that make sense, everybody? Or if you don't want to type, if it doesn't make sense, you could just let me know, and I'll rephrase. But I hope I didn't take you guys off on a tangent. I just want to make sure. Cool. Thank you, Sam. I hope I didn't take you guys off on too much of a tangent. I just want to make sure we're all okay on it. Cool. I'm happy to explain a little more. So, Jamal, what I'm trying to think. Good, Stephanie, cool. Just for clarification, if you negate the answer choice, let me jump back to Stephanie's real quick, and then I'm going to attack what Jamal was asking. Just for clarification, if you negate the answer choices and one, when negated, destroys the conclusion, then that is the correct answer. Yeah, good point, Stephanie. So I'm glad you're clarifying this, Stephanie. Anybody who needs clarification or anything should. And that's why I wanted to write these out. Stephanie, you might want to use my rule, because I go and I explicitly say that that's the correct answer choice. Because it can be a little confusing. It's almost a little counterintuitive. The one that doesn't work, the one that, if you make that assumption false, makes the argument fall apart, that is the correct answer for our purposes. So again, it's a little counterintuitive, Stephanie, because you're negating that answer choice. The argument falls apart, so it's not working for the argument very well. But that is the correct answer choice. So is that clear, Stephanie? Did I clarify it? And we could, I think Sam kind of explains why it works. He says they're asking for something that's necessary. So if negated, the argument survives, then it wasn't necessary. Yeah, so like, again, it seems counterintuitive. That's why I say this is sort of a good way of thinking of it as a litmus test. A litmus test. Because like you get this sort of like you get this sort of I guess this result from negating it that you wouldn't get with anything else. And even though it's not a good result, the argument falls apart, that's the result you're looking for to test what you're doing. So that's the way it works. The one that negates and you negate it and it falls apart, that's the correct answer choice. Counterintuitively, but true. And Sam kind of explains a good reason why, if you want to think it through. But at least for the purposes of the rules, again, I think everyone kind of understands the concept from my feedback I got before, for the most part, of how these things work. Like, it's just the floor. This has to be true. This litmus test, it's almost like, it's funny, like, I say this to a lot of my students. Sometimes, like, you almost don't necessarily need to know why it works. Or, I mean, it's good to know why it works and you can trust in it. And, you know, remember, we're doing this to be, we're trying to think and reason, so it's a good thing to understand why something works. But I'll be honest with you, there are times I just kind of forget why something works, but I know it does. And I can go back and kind of figure it out afterwards. It's almost like if I turn on a light, I don't necessarily know how. You know, if it's a series circuit or a parallel circuit or how the electricity flows and gets here from the electric company, I don't have quite an understanding. I just know if I turn on the light switch, it works. Same sort of thing. I'll be honest with you, Stephanie. You might forget, or Sam, right? You might forget why this works. I forget sometimes, and I go back and figure it out. But the point is, as long as you know that this is the rule, then you can apply it. But at the very least, on the first time, it's good to understand why, and I think Sam provides a good answer. So, I'm sorry for blabbering too long. If I have, let me get back to Jamal. Jamal had a great question. He was, and I want everyone to feel comfortable to ask questions like these, because there's so much material to learn here that if you miss a fundamental early on, like conclusions or premises, I had a student, you know, was scoring pretty well, was scoring, I don't know, high 150s, wanted to get into the 160s. And he still had trouble identifying. He wasn't sure what what a conclusion was. He didn't even he didn't understand what I meant by a premise. And he was scoring pretty well. And again, it's not a knock on him. It's kind of like when you're first learning math. There might be some fundamentals that you learn early on where if you're missing them, then you've got a blind spot. It hampers you. So, Jamal, I'm glad you're asking for clarification on conclusion. When I say conclusion, right, there could be more than one conclusion. Relatively speaking, there could be like sort of a sub-conclusion or an intermediate conclusion. But for the purposes of this argument, we're looking for the main conclusion. And the way you get at the main conclusion is it doesn't support anything else. So, I don't know, if I said something like, if I said something like, oh, it's raining out, so I like running in the rain, but I'm going to dress for the rain. So I'm gonna wear my hat. I'm gonna wear my sneakers that are better for the rain. I want to make sure I'm safe. So I'm going to do all this. Right, like there's a bunch of premises in there, and there's a bunch of like sort of sub conclusions. But at the end of the day, right, the main reason I'm doing all of this is because, like, you could say, oh, well, I like running in the rain. Sure, that might be a sub conclusion. But the main reason I'm doing all of this, taking on this extra, I'm going to wear like my special sneakers and my hat, is because I want to make sure I'm safe when I'm running in the rain. That's like the main conclusion. I don't know if this is the best example, but like, I guess my point is that every premises, whether it's directly or indirectly, goes to support the idea that I want to be safe when I'm running in the rain. That's why that's my main conclusion. Does that make sense at all, Jamal, or did I confuse you more? I just kind of made up the example on the spot, so I hope I didn't throw you off. That makes sense? Okay, cool. So it's the ultimate conclusion. Everything goes to support it, even if there's a premise that goes to support sort of an intermediate conclusion. Like, the point is, they all, at the end of the day, are supporting the main conclusion. I like to think of it maybe as sort of like building blocks, right? Like, or a table, right? Like, you're creating legs under a table, and your table is your main conclusion, right? Your legs are your premises. Right, or your details. They're all there to support the table, the top, that main conclusion. Right? It's all, everything goes to support that one umbrella argument. So, cool. I hope that still makes sense. If you want, just in the interest of time, feel free to PM me or message me after if anyone has any questions on conclusion, because it's a fundamental that's important, and I want to make sure you all get it. And again, don't be afraid to ask questions as we're going through this. So, let us move on to our example. Let's try. Can everyone see my screen? I hope. We're gonna focus on number 9. And I'll tell you what. I'm going to, because I don't want anyone cheating. I get the temptation. I am going to make it so that you cannot see the answer choices. So can everyone see my screen okay? Like, can everyone see number 9? Or is it too big? Okay, excellent. All right. Is number 9 the full deal, right? We don't see the answer choices. So this is, by the way, this is the Juno 7 free LSAT that LSAT gives out. I'm using this because that makes it so much easier to deal with. Jamal, you can see the answer choices? Oh, okay. Oh, I know why. Let me see if I can fix this. Let me see something. I'll tell you what. Well, for those of you who can see it, try not to focus on them. Try not to read them if you can. Try to avoid. I just don't want to mess that up. Let me see what I can do here. I don't want to mess anything up. Yeah, great point, Sam. I did scroll up, but I wonder if maybe I've got it set up on something that's not. Yeah, I did scroll up, but I guess maybe I've got it set up so it's focused on I think I've got it set up so it's focused on that document, and that's what might be complicating this. Let me see if there's a way I can alter that. Bear with me one moment. I don't want to take up too much of your time on this technical thing. It's not that big a deal. I just want to, Yeah, so I've scrolled up. That didn't change anything, huh, guys? All right, cool. You know what? Honor code. Ignore the answers. You're only cheating yourself if you focus on the answer choices. The reason I say that, let me just explain real quick why I say that. Like, honestly, this is probably one of the exceptions where you can get away with it. But for the most part, if you see the answer choices, you can be biased to something. I don't want you to do that. Like, that's how they really get you on their sucker choices. So that's why I really want you to make predictions beforehand. Look, there are 100 to 101 questions on this test. I'll tell you, every time I took the test, I would make a prediction. I used to teach for Kaplan, and they had this phrase. Actually, this is something you might all want to write down. I will send it. The phrase is predict before you peek. And by that, they mean predict before you peek at the answer choices. And the reason is because, like, you could see something. They're not putting these answer choices here by accident, especially the LSAT. These are crafty test makers. They're putting answer choices there to have, you know, what JY would call attractor answer choices that are going to throw you off. And so if you look at these and they catch your eye, they could bias you. I mean, that's the purpose of them. They make them very attractive. They use keywords that are going to be attractive to you. So that's why I really want you to take a moment before, process the question, and make a prediction beforehand. It'll put you in a much stronger place when you go to analyze the question types. You're going to compare it to what you're looking for. And you're going to be far less likely to pick the attractor choice. So that being said, let's jump at this question. So, okay, the question itself, which one of the following is an assumption on which the naturalist's argument depends, right? So, again, all I need to know when I'm taking this test, if I'm on the LSAT, is I see the word assumption, I see the word depends. That tells me I've got my two keywords here, assumption, right? And then depends, it is a necessary assumption question. By the way, naturalists, great. We're dealing with that stuff. But that's all, you know, the point is that we want to look at this like a template so we can go right to our strategy. Whether it's a naturalist or a botanist or whatever, it doesn't matter so much. What matters is the structure of the logical argument. So again, necessary assumption. I know that because of my two keywords. Great. I'm automatic. Now I'm going to go to my stimulus. So, naturalist, this is the naturalist's argument. The recent claims that the Tasmanian tiger is not extinct are false. Okay, let me let's just look at that first sentence real quick, because these can be very dense here. What do you think that's jumping out at me at this first sentence? This isn't so important for necessary assumption, but I think it's important for understanding how to read these things. We're reading like lawyers, right? What is a little bit challenging about this first sentence? Can anyone guess? Jamal, sounds like conclusion. Nice, nice. Now I see. Yeah. So good. Let's hold off. We don't know for certain yet if it's a conclusion because we haven't read the whole thing unless if you jump ahead. It may or may not be, but I like that you're thinking about it. And I like that you guys are, I think the people that are saying conclusion, right, they have a sense of how conclusions are written, whether it's through keywords, the way things are stated in an authoritative way. This could be the conclusion. We don't know for certain yet. We're going to read through the whole thing. But I think the one thing I really want to point out is, like a lot of people said, you've got not and false. That means double negative, right? So what is this guy really saying? Guy or girl, forgive me. What is a naturalist really saying? That according to the naturalist, at least, these claims, the reason claims that Tasmanian, by the way, Lauren, good to be on the lookout for claims, right? Because we're talking about the claims, really. The reason claims the Tasmanian tiger is not extinct are false. So the claims are false, right? And then I think it's fair to say that this naturalist believes that, the double negative, you just negate it the way you would in math, not extinct, not false. So that means the naturalist believes that this tiger is not extinct. Is that they are extinct. Oh, my God, I'm falling for it. Is that they are extinct. Even extinct is sort of a negative in a way, but that they are extinct. Excellent, Emily. The naturalist believes a tiger is extinct. And by the way, notice that they're doing a lot of things here. They're throwing big words, like relatively big words, a lot of syllables, like even though they're not that bad, but like Tasmanian. This is all to throw you off. The point is it's a tiger. We could just call it T. It doesn't matter. But excellent, Emily. The first sentence is almost saying they're extinct. And the reason I'm doing this is because, like, there's this temptation to rush through because of the time constraints, but at the same time, you're doing yourself a disservice because of the way these things are worded in very complex ways. You always want to make sure you stop for a second and process it. Make sure you've got what this sentence is saying, because even a one line like this can be rather complex. So we got that double negative. We're not going to let it trip us up. They're saying the claims are false, but they're also essentially saying that the tiger is extinct. All right, now let's go further. The Tasmanian tiger's natural habitat was taken over by sheep farming decades ago. Okay, resulting in the animal's systematic elimination from the area. Okay, all right, so sheep farming took over, and then the animal's not in the area anymore, right? If they're going to do the sheep farming, well, I guess the tiger, as powerful as this tiger is, apparently these sheep farmers kicked him out, kicked her out, whatever, right? So the tiger's, that's one of the premises. Amy, I'm going to see what you're writing here. When you say predict the answer, are you actually taking a few seconds to figure it out, like literally pausing and then going to the answer choices? Yes, Amy, I am. It isn't as, I will say this might be the one where you don't necessarily need it, but I still think it's important, yeah. And I think, Amy, I want to – let's just take a jump here and address what Amy's saying. So the reason this is important is because it forced you to process the question. Again, people think, oh, it's just a paragraph. It's all based on this one blurb. But no, this is rather complex. There's a lot of factors going on here. So if you jump into the answer choice, it's like, oh, well, it's got to be these one out of five. I mean, it's not like I have to – right, the big thing about multiple choice questions is we think, oh, well, great, at least it's multiple choice. They're doing me a favor. I've got a chance of getting it right. No, they're not doing you a favor. Quite the opposite. they're making it harder because they're going to use these answer choices to throw you off. Like I said, they're going to create attractor choices. So if you sit there and you process the question, and then you've got like a sense of what the answer, even if you're not 100% right, or even if you're a little bit off, but you have some area, some target of where the answer should fall, you now have a standard to compare every answer choice to. So now, now you're in a much stronger place. Now you're less likely to fall for attractive choices. Does that make sense? I'm just reading the rest of what you said. And when you know that there's no way to predict because some questions are designed that way really, really hard, then what is your take? Well, I honestly, Amy, let me address what you're saying, because I think what I said kind of resonated with you from your response. But let me just address that last one. So I will say these necessary assumption questions, these are the ones where maybe you can get away with it. I still think it's a good idea to take a second and predict. I believe it actually will save you some work. But on ones where you can't make a prediction, I think the answer is that you want to come as close to one as you can. Like, so maybe you don't, maybe you won't know, okay, because like, when we're saying prediction, it doesn't have to be like dead on, this is the answer, because we can't predict the wording they're going to use. We just have some sense of things. Maybe your prediction is going to be broader. Like, maybe like, instead of just saying, okay, it's the red car, I don't know, I'm making something up. You'll be like, okay, well, it's a mode of transportation. I don't know, right? Again, that's much broader than the red car. But that puts you in a place where it would narrow you, like, from another answer choice that is not a mode of transportation. So even if it's a broad guess, you want to try to get as narrow as possible, even if it's broad, just so you have some idea. And again, that another key part of this is it forces you to process it so you understand it more. And that puts you in a much stronger place. But again, it's often hard to, like, predict exactly what they're going to say. But if you're somewhere zeroing in somewhere, then you're in a much stronger place. And yes, Tyler, that's a great point. I think that's what I mean by process it. Like, even if you don't have a prediction, it by like sitting through there and making a prediction, it has the other benefit of helping you to make sure you understand the stimulus. Because if you have to make a prediction, that means you have to really think through these stimulus. You have to read it much more carefully, these stimuli. And you're going to be in a much stronger place than you would if you didn't make a prediction. So it has two benefits that all kind of serve the same purpose. Does that make sense? Okay, Amy, good question. Don't be sorry, but let's address that later, and I want you to hold on to that. I think I'll remember, but if I don't, remind me. It's a great question, and it's something I think is going to benefit you all. So if you all stick around when we're done with this part, we'll talk about skipping. And I'm glad, Amy, you brought that up. I just want to stay on this for our purposes, but I promise you we'll address it. So, all right, let's move on to our next sentence. So they said this thing about the sheep, right? And by the way, look at what I'm doing. I'm not – it's obviously taking longer because we're talking this out, but I want you to sort of think of it and engage in it the same way. Like, it's almost like you're thinking and reasoning through it with me because there's a lot going on here. Like, you got to look at this second sentence and be like, okay, well, apparently these sheep – in your mind, you don't want to just read it like blindly – we could all read on autopilot. You know, the Tasmanian tiger's natural habitat was taken over. No. That's not enough. You want to read it and sort of, like, process it, picture it in a way if you can. It might sound like it takes more time, but frankly, it makes you more effective. So you want to just be like, okay, well, all right, these sheep people push the tiger off its land. Great, okay. Since then, naturalists working on the region – so now these naturalists working on the region have discovered no hard evidence of its survival, such as carcasses or tracks. So, okay, these sheep people sheep farmers kicked the tiger off the land because they want to do the sheep farming. Apparently, that did it. Now they're not there. And these naturalists couldn't find traces of the dead bodies. That's what a carcass is, right? Or tracks of this Tasmanian tiger. Okay, all right, that's another premise. All right. In spite of alleged sighting now, the naturalists didn't see any. But in spite of alleged sightings of the animal, so maybe a sheep farmer saw the animal, right? The Tasmanian tiger no longer exists. Okay. Let's think about this. There's a lot going on here. Let's just try to – we have a sense of everything. We sort of processed every sentence. Then let's try to process it as a whole. Let's go back to – I think it's fair to say – I think, Jamal, great job. You were saying that first sentence sounds like the conclusion, right? And I think it could be – I think I think it's fair to say the first sentence is the conclusion. And basically that first sentence is like – basically says that Tasmanian tiger is extinct. I mean, if you want to look at it, the last sentence kind of acknowledges that there were sightings, but they say it no longer exists. So, I mean, that second part of the last sentence is sort of saying the same thing as the first sentence. They're almost one of the same, right? Because they're claimed, right, the alleged sightings of it. I saw it. I mean, I guess the first and last sentences are kind of saying the same thing. But look, the main conclusion is that this tiger is extinct. This Tasmanian tiger is extinct. So that's our conclusion, right? All these other premises support this. These sheep farmers took over, pushed the tiger off the land. Naturalists haven't seen it, right? So those are our premises. And that all supports this idea that despite what everyone says, the Tasmanian tiger is extinct. So that's our argument. Everything has to be supporting that. So now we want to find an assumption where it is necessary for this conclusion to be true, that the tiger is extinct. So let's go through. Actually, no. Let's do what we're supposed to do. Let's make predictions. What is something that has to be true? Can anyone guess? And again, it could be tough on some of these. But what is something that has to? What's an assumption that has to be true before we look at the answer choices? That has to be true for this argument to be true, for this argument to be correct. What is an assumption that has to be true for the idea that the tiger is extinct? Anyone want to make any guesses? Let me see what we got here. Reju, TT only lived in its natural habitat. Nice. I think that's fair. Where, like, yeah, maybe it could only live. Maybe that habitat had some, like, vegetation that the tiger ate and nowhere else has that the tiger needs. Stephanie, naturalists discovered no hard evidence. So we're thinking about must be true, right? So no hard evidence. I'm trying to think about that. No hard evidence. I don't know. I mean, they could have discovered no hard evidence of its existence. I mean, just because we haven't discovered evidence, that doesn't mean that it's not extinct. Unless if I'm reading what you're saying wrong. Tiger is not able to live anywhere else besides... Good, Emily, you said something similar to Riju. Sam, they haven't been sighted anywhere else. Let me think about that. Okay, yeah. I'm a little worried about that one just because... No, that's fair. Like, I mean, that – well, there's the argument is that it's extinct, right? The argument is that it's extinct. And they could not be sighted and still be around. I'm giving what's an example of an absence of evidence flaw, which if you go into flaws, you'll see. But don't sweat it. Even if your guesses aren't dead on, the fact that you're guessing means that you're making predictions, and that means you're processing this, and you're going to be far less likely to pick the wrong choice. So good. I like the guesses, and I like that you guys are putting yourself out there. Even if you're off, it's okay. The fact that you're like engaged is honestly, you could be engaged and make a mistake, but you could still get this question right. It's the people that aren't engaged, that aren't making guesses, that I worry about, because you need to be actively involved in this question. Let's see. Let me look at some of these other ones. Soft evidence do not play a significant role to prove. Okay, cool. Soft evidence do not play a role. Yeah, I think that's fair, right? Someone thought they saw it. You know, people think they see aliens, right? Like, that doesn't... how would that factor in here? Again, what is the conclusion? The conclusion is that it's extinct. So we could say all these soft evidences that we've seen them don't make sense. Okay, that's fair. But look, I don't want to get too much in. I'm glad you're making predictions. I think we've got some good ones. I think the natural habitat is pretty good, right? That it has to be in its natural habitat. There are some others too. But I like the fact that you guys are engaged in making predictions. That's going to put you in a good place if we're doing this. Now let's move into our rule. We're going to go to the answer choices. And by the way, please don't approach them. Wait to do them with me. We're going to do our strategy. The reason I want you to wait to do them with me is because I want to apply this together and show you how I would do it. So that way you get hopefully you get the most out of it that way. And also, I want to also show you how I think it's a good idea to approach answer choices. I know time is an issue, but I really want you to look at every answer choice. Because you could think that C is the perfect answer, and you're like, oh man, I got to go, I got time, I got to move to the next question. But then what do? They make E the correct answer. And C was close, but no cigar. So that's why I want you to look at every answer choice. But let me just look at these last ones before. Stephanie, carcasses haven't been found anywhere else in the world. Okay, that's true. But here's another thing, right? Just because there isn't evidence, and I think this might be what Riju was saying, because what I was kind of saying before, just because there isn't evidence, I mean, it might add to it, it might strengthen it, but just because there isn't evidence doesn't mean that something's not true. Like, maybe those tigers are all still alive. They just moved into a different region. So, but good. I like that we're guessing. Now, let's jump into the answer choices. Again, our rule. Now we're going to go to our rule. What's our rule? Our rule is let's negate it, and then we'll see if the argument falls apart. Again, the argument is that the claims are false, or that the argument, or that the, which would mean that the tiger is extinct. The argument is that the tiger is extinct. Remember that if you're doing this. The tiger is extinct. So we want something, when we negate these rules, is going to make the argument that the tiger extinct falls apart. So, sheep farming drove the last Tasmanian tigers to starvation by chasing them from their natural habitat. Okay, now let's negate this. Now here's the tricky part. Here's the tricky part. Like, what do I mean by negate? When I say negate, I mean there's also like rules for negation. I don't want you to necessarily hold to those. I think the best way to do this is a more practical rather than conceptual way. Picture an example of this not being true. Yeah, you like right, Amy, right? Logical opposite. So, but the best way to do the logical opposite for our purposes here is to picture it as not being true. An example of it not being true. So sheep farming drove the last Tasmanian tigers to starvation by chasing them from their natural habitat. What's an example of them not being true? Like just an example. Let's see if we can think of some. I'll think of something. Let's see. So if let's say it wasn't the sheep farming. Yeah, let's say Sam, right? Let's say they weren't driven to starvation. Let's say that they let's say it drove them out of there, right? But they had plenty of food somewhere else. But maybe there are predators over there that killed off the tigers. You know, like someone stronger than a tiger. I don't know. Napoleon Dynamite would say maybe there's a liger, and the liger like got the tigers, or like a wolf. I don't know. Maybe right, Jamal. Maybe it drove them to a compatible habitat. It doesn't necessarily mean that they're extinct. Or maybe they chose to go. Maybe it wasn't even the sheep farming, and they were fine. So if that's true, right, if that's negated, does the argument fall apart? They're saying that the tigers are extinct. Well, they don't necessarily have to be extinct if any of these things happen. Wait, what am I saying? What am I saying? Yeah, if we negate it, right? So the argument doesn't necessarily have to fall apart. They're saying the right. So they're saying that the tiger's extinct, but just because A is negated, right? They chose to go somewhere else. There were other things they could eat or whatever. The argument doesn't necessarily fall apart, right? Like the argument could still be true. They could still be, it doesn't have to, A doesn't have to make the negating A doesn't make the argument that they're extinct fall apart. Laura, is it going against the premise? What premise do you mean? The start of the second sentence. Okay, so I don't know if it's necessarily going against resulting in animal systematic elimination from the area. It could still be in sync with the premise. So, they're just saying the habitat was taken over. I don't know, but it's eliminated from the area. Okay, so that does go with, that is consistent with the premise. But here's the thing, right? What doesn't have, what we have wiggle room on is they could leave, right? They could leave that area. Hey, these sheep farmers kicked them out. But that doesn't mean they went to starvation, as that doesn't necessarily mean they went to starvation, right? As some of the other people were saying, right? Like Jamal was saying, hey, it could drove them to a comparable habitat, or who else said something? Sam said they weren't driven to starvation, right? So it's still consistent with that premise you're talking about. It's just they didn't necessarily starve. Right, so if we're negating that, if they didn't starve, right, does that they didn't starve, right? So does that mean that they're extinct? Well, if they didn't starve, they could or could not be extinct, right? So there are ways they could be extinct or not be extinct. So it doesn't make the conclusion fall apart. Jamal, decades of clo doesn't imply today, maybe, right, let's see. The first part, yeah, you mean that it's been consistent away. I mean, the first part, they could have been driven out decades ago but come back. I think it sort of implies that they kept them out. But resulting in an animal systematic elimination of the area, I think that pretty much makes it so that they haven't come back. Does that make sense, Jamal? Cool. But if we negate A, we're not necessarily destroying the argument. The tiger could still be alive. It could just be eating somewhere else, right? So the argument we're trying to destroy is the idea that they're extinct. And they don't necessarily have to be extinct. Does that make sense? Let's see. Before we jump to B, question, could answer choice A be a sufficient assumption? That could be, if it were true, yes, it could be a sufficient assumption. Yes. Right? I don't want to get too much into what makes a sufficient assumption because I don't want to confuse anybody, but to answer your question, Emily, yes, because remember, sufficient means that it kind of triggers it to happen, right? So if they go into starvation, well, if they, by definition, starving, I think a fair meaning of starving, people overuse it. It doesn't necessarily mean just being really hungry. It means you starve, you die. So, I think that could qualify Emily, yes, as a sufficient assumption, if that makes any sense. But here's the thing. I think it's fair to say with A. Now, I want to go down each one of these, right? And I want you to think of these answer choices as one of three things: whether it is a contender, whether it's wrong when you cross it out, or whether you're unsure. I'm gonna guess. I don't, if everyone's in agreement with me. You can let me know. If you're not in agreement with me, you don't have to let me know. Or even if you want privacy, because it's okay if you're embarrassed. If you still don't get it, you can always, you have a way to message just me, if you want to do that. But I think it's fair to say that A is not going to be our answer choice, because A doesn't necessarily destroy the argument that they're extinct if we negate it, right? If these tigers didn't go into starvation, well, right, the argument that they're extinct. It doesn't necessarily destroy the argument. Maybe they did, maybe they didn't. It could go either way. We want something that just destroys the argument, that they're extinct. Is that cool? So I'm going to go on to B, and if anyone still has any questions, you can email me through all or privately to stop me. B. Some scavengers in Tasmania are capable of destroying tiger carcasses without a trace. Okay. So some scavengers are capable of destroying tiger carcasses without a trace. Let's make this not true. So let's make it so that, I mean, an example of it not being true. Let's make it so that logical opposite. No scavengers. Now look at this double negative. So let's just say that, okay, essentially what this means is there are scavengers that can just destroy the carcasses so you don't see them. Okay, fine. Let's say that that's not true, that whenever these scavengers do it, you definitely see these carcasses. All right. Great. So we definitely see these carcasses. Let's just see how that applies. I mean, if you definitely see these carcasses, great. But like you with these scavengers, right? You're going to see the carcasses. But okay, great. I mean, great. Now I would see the carcasses. But just because I see carcasses or can see carcasses, does that necessarily mean that they're not extinct? Or that they are extinct? I mean, it doesn't. It's circumstantial evidence, for lack of a better explanation. Amy, I mean, even if we were to check to see if the answer is true, some can equal just one, two. Yeah, I mean, some can equal just one, two, right? But so that's what I'm saying. Let's just make it so that there's no, not a single carcass, not a single scavenger that can do that. So whenever a scavenger does it, there are carcasses that you could see. But just because that you could see carcasses doesn't mean that the doesn't maybe I could see a carcass, maybe I can't. Right, like maybe there's gonna be carcasses left over. Maybe they can't. That doesn't really tell me whether the animal's extinct or not, because maybe someone just hasn't stumbled across the carcass. Maybe the carcass is buried. Maybe they got dumped in the sea. We just don't know. It doesn't tell us. It doesn't negate the idea that the thing's extinct. Yeah, Sam, great point. It still leaves open the possibility they exist in another region. Great, cool. All right. And by the way, listen, I hope if I'm boring anybody or if I'm taking it a little slow because it's our first example. So if I'm boring anybody, tell me, or you can give me feedback privately if you want. I want to make sure we're getting this for everybody. I'm sorry if this one's going a little bit slow. I noticed a couple people left. Maybe they're time constraints. But I want to keep you all engaged. For those of you that aren't engaged, feel free to speak up and join in any way you like.
I think you're doing great, dude. I think what you're doing is awesome. If you want to engage people, you can literally just say, "Hey, who wants to?" You could say, "Who wants to deal with this?" And then you can unmute them because you have I believe, as the presenter, you have the power. So you can be more of an interface with talking as well as just listening to them chat.
Cool. All right, nice. Thank you, Dave. I'll tell you
My
what. We're gonna go. Well, how about this? We're gonna go through. We're gonna finish up this one. On the next one, I will let people jump in if you like. So, is that cool? I hope so. All right. Well, we're almost done with this subject. Let's take a look at C. Every naturalist working in the Tasmanian tiger's natural habitat has looked systematically for evidence of the tiger's survival. All right. Wow. Okay. There's a lot of interesting words here. Every naturalist. Right? Working in the Tasmanian tiger's natural habitat has looked systematically for evidence of the tiger's survival. So let's just, I mean, a way to negate it, right, is to find the logical opposite. So, or any, I think the best way to think of it, instead of if logical opposite hangs you up, just think of an example that doesn't fit here, right? So they're saying every naturalist. Let's say not every naturalist. Let's just say some naturalists have and some haven't. Every naturalist working in the Tasmanian blah 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 natural habitat looks systematically for evidence. Let's say not every naturalist did. Like, does that make a difference? If like you've got 100 naturalists that exist in this habitat and they all look for it and they don't, find it, fine. But now only 99 did, or only 50 did out of the 100. I mean, does that really tell us everything? Does it necessarily mean that it's extinct or not? Yeah, right? Excellent. The argument still stands. Good. Cool. So I think exactly, Tyler. So I think we're good. C doesn't do anything for us. Let's look at D. The Tasmanian tiger did not move and adapt to a different region in response to the loss of habitat. Okay. Oh, Amy, you like this one. All right. The Tasmanian tiger did not move and adapt to a different region in response to the loss of the habitat. Okay, this is interesting. Now, if we think about our predictions, I think a lot of everyone was talking about, I think if I remember correctly, people were talking about, right, like the habitat and how the habitat was super important, right? Because it was all about, hey, we don't have these guys, they got driven out. Well, and they couldn't, you know, well, I mean, this kind of gets it. So this sounds like it's the required argument that we were predicting. We're talking about the habitat and how it had to stay there, right? So now, let's see if Amy's right. The argument falls apart. Let's negate it. The Tasmanian tiger did not move and adapt to a different region. So let's say it did move and adapt to a different region. If it did move, right, they're saying the it's extinct. Well, if it did move, then that argument could fall apart. Right, if it did move, then we don't know for certain that it's extinct. It might be around, and we just don't see it. Right, so by negating it, by saying that it moved, the argument, it isn't necessarily true that it's extinct. Does that make sense, everybody? Yeah, right, Amy? So, like, if it moved, we don't know for certain if it's extinct, it was extinct. But if we have this small area that we can all see and know that it got pushed out of that area, and that's the only place we know it didn't move and it got kicked out, well, then it has to be extinct. So that's why this is the answer choice. And again, if you want to negate it, that leaves open the possibility that it's not extinct, which is against the conclusion, right? So that's why it proves. So that's why D should be our answer. Now, I'm with you guys. I'm like 99% certain this is the answer choice. Let's just take a look at E real quick. Those who have reported sightings of the Tasmanian tiger are not experienced naturalists. Again, we want to double check because maybe we're certain about D, but we only got one more to check. So, Amy doesn't like E. Those who have reported sightings of the Tasmanian tiger are not experienced naturalists. Okay, great. They're not. Let's think about this. They're not experienced naturalists. Well, I mean, they may not be, but they may know a Tasmanian tiger when they see it because they know how dangerous these things are. I mean, maybe the Tasmanian tiger has, like, this special symbol on its face. I don't know. But the point is that, like, that doesn't tell us that they're necessarily wrong. And more to the point, let's negate it. Let's say they are experienced naturalists. An experienced naturalist had a sighting. Does that make the argument fall apart that they're extinct? I mean, experienced naturalists could make a mistake. So it's all circumstantial, right? Great, Amy, no difference. I'm going to see a question for C, if it were some naturalist working in the tiger's natural habitat have looked systematically for evidence of tiger survival, would that make any difference? For C. Well, if we negated it, right? Let's just say, we could say, we'll think of an example of not some, right? So maybe no. No naturalists working in the tigers. So if none of them looked for evidence, this goes to like the whole absence of evidence flaw. If none of them looked for evidence, I mean, I could not look for evidence of something. That doesn't mean it's not true or true. Like, it doesn't quite change things. Does that make sense, Riju? A great, great point. But I think even if we made it some, right, like we negated it by saying no, it won't make much of a difference. Does that make sense? Cool. All right. So I hope this one was helpful. That was the first one with me doing it. I'll tell you what. I want to get everyone engaged. So I'm going to ask someone to – who wants to volunteer? We don't necessarily have to have a volunteer for the whole thing, but maybe we'll have someone read it, and then we could have someone walk us through it. And then answer choices. Who wants to maybe read it and kind of walk through how we're going to tackle it?
And if they don't volunteer, you can make them.
Oh, I might put someone on the spot. Okay. So who? Anyone want to volunteer? I'll give you a second or two to reply. And by the way, this is fun. We're not trying to mess with anybody. I hope everyone knows we're all trying to support each other here.
Yeah, I want to make a point. I said this. I've said this, I think, almost in every time. When you volunteer, when you when you put yourself out there to mess up, that's not only will that help you, it's going through difficulties helps, but it's also really good. Excuse me. I have a child. Sorry. Lucy, hold on. Hold on. Okay. All right. Sorry, guys. The point I was trying to make was, hold on, as you can see, I have taken my kids to the park while we're doing this. But the point of this is that you're doing not only yourself a benefit by struggling through, but you're also doing everybody else who's listening a huge service because we see, oh, that's exactly what I do. So don't be afraid to volunteer, and don't be afraid when you're forced to volunteer.
Cool. I don't think Dave could say it any better. Let me just also put something out there. I think some of you might have seen my post. If you want to talk about it later, we can. I got a 173, but I got that 173 because I was willing to put myself out there and fail a bunch of times. I got a 149 on my first PT. I got a 162 on my first actual LSAT, then a 165. And I wasn't afraid to fail. I wasn't afraid to get scores I wasn't necessarily satisfied with. You know, at the end of the day, like, I learned, I know it's a cliche, but I learned more from my mistakes. All right, Jamal, my man, all right, cool. So you're up for the challenge. That makes me happy. All right. By the way, my dad's name is Jamal, so that's why I really like your name. Jamal, I'm going to unmute you. I think I've got this. Before I ask Dave to step in, I'm going to see if I can do it myself.
Jamal, you can unmute yourself, too, if you want. There you go.
Oh, there we go. Hello.
Right there, Jamal. Hey, Jamal, how you doing?
Great. How are you doing?
Excellent. Thank you so much for volunteering.
No problem.
So you see number 11 over there?
Yes.
So start by reading. Let's do this in steps, right? I hope you don't mind. I'm a fan of reading the question first.
Okay.
At least for our purposes today, because we're focusing on the question, would you mind reading that, and we'll discuss real quick?
True, no problem. The argument depends on assuming that.
Cool. So I'm sorry to interrupt. I know this is going to sound I'm probably over-teaching here, but better to be safe because we never know if anyone missed anything. I would assume you would agree that this is a necessary assumption question. What
yes.
makes it a necessary assumption question?
We have our keyword depends. On assuming.
Excellent. We've got the word assume, which has to be there, and then depends is what makes it a necessary assumption. Excellent. So, cool. Now, so then we know, okay, what's a necessary assumption question? We go over our strategy, which, as we all know, is negate the answer choice and see which one makes the argument fall apart. But let me not blabber on too long. Why don't you go ahead and read the stimulus? And feel free if you want. If you want to stop as you're reading it, and like, I know you're going to be doing the reading, but like, you know, if you've got a complex sentence, feel free to stop, even if it's in the middle of the sentence, and like, sort of process it out loud and say, okay, what does this mean? Sort of paraphrase it. Because that's a power.
Hello? Hello?
I can hear you, Jamal.
Okay, thank you. I couldn't hear anyone.
Yeah, I think that his computer might have died, or he's all still on the call.
Uh-oh. Jimmy, I think we've lost you.
I can
Jimmy?
See him.
I know, but I can't hear him.
Yes.
Jimmy, can we hear you? I think you've muted yourself.
Nope.
There you go.
Sorry, guys. I don't think I did, but maybe I didn't realize it. I apologize.
I, you know, my fat thumb could have accidentally done it, too. So, anywho. I'll let you go back to it.
Sure. So I'm sorry. Thanks, Jamal. Feel free to jump in here, and feel free to stop as you go if you want to process this out loud.
Okay. Feathers recently taken from seabirds, stuffed and preserved in the 1880s, have been found to contain only half as much mercury as feathers recently taken from living birds of the same species. Okay.
Hey, if I may, I get the sense you want to stop, but I think
yes.
I mean, we should. Let's think about that. A good way to, I'm sorry to jump in here, but just a little bit. I think a good way, tell us in your own words what's happening here. And don't let yourself be thrown off. Try not to let yourself be thrown off, because they're using these goofy things like seabirds in the 1880s. Like, we can laugh about it. Who cares? Whatever. They're going to do it, right? But let's just kind of go with it, have a sense of humor about it. So feel free, talk us through it. What's happening here with these seabirds?
Okay, we have stuffed and preserved seabirds of 1880s, and they have half the amount of mercury as in their feathers compared to birds of the same species that are found recently, are the living birds that are found recently.
Good point. Yeah, and by the way, Jamal is reading like a lawyer, right? Living birds recently compared to stuffed birds. There is a deal, like, these birds now are not stuffed. But yes. When they say half as much mercury, so let's picture that visually, right? Like, I don't know, on a scale of 100, right, half as much. That's how I don't know about you guys, but this helps me. Half as much. Like, let's just say if it's a scale of 100, then they've got the ones that have half as much as 50, and the regular ones have 100, you know? So which ones have half as much, the 1880s or now? 1880s. Yeah. Yeah, right? Because they're the ones with half as much. They've got, say, 50 on a scale of 100.
Yeah.
And this is the feathers. The feathers have this mercury. Okay. Cool. So any other observations you want to take from this, or do you want to go on to the next sentence?
I'm questioning, like, the comparison of preserved birds to living birds, but I think you already mentioned that.
No, that's good, good. No, good. And I like what Jamal did, right? Like, these are like things we want to be mindful of, right? Because these aren't perfect comparisons, living to preserved, right? So things like that. And then, I might be overanalyzing it, but it's about feathers, right? It's not the bird itself. So I don't know if that's going to make a difference. But yeah, you want to look at these little things that could make a difference. And I like Jamal's pointing out. You want to, like, observe these things that might make a difference, that it's about living compared to stuffed. Good. Good. Anything else?
I like your point on the feathers. I think that helps.
It might, yeah, right? It may or may not, we're just throwing things out here. Because the funny thing is, right, there could be little things that we might overlook. So we want to see, like, specific words they use sometimes that could make a difference in these sort of LSAT technicalities.
Okay.
Cool. So unless you see anything else, we can move on to the next one.
I guess the focus on mercury. Why are we singling out mercury?
Right? Why are we singling out mercury? Maybe, right? So yeah, we want to be curious. We want to take note of these things. It helps us read actively. And then that'll, you know, because if we kind of like overlook these things, then we're disengaged and we might miss something. So yeah, I don't know. I wonder why. Like, mercury indicates something, or maybe they're just interested in mercury. But good, yeah. Apparently, mercury is what we're measuring. Anything else?
Nothing that sticks out at this point.
Cool. And by the way, I want to emphasize to everyone what Jamal and I were doing, particularly Jamal, right? Like, making these observations keeps us engaged. And I know that sounds like, you guys have probably heard tons of things read actively, and I don't think that's always explained very well. But here's the difference. If you read on autopilot, because, I mean, we could all read on autopilot. Feathers recently taken seabird stuffed and preserved in the 1880s have been found to contain only half. I mean, I could read without even knowing what I'm reading. We all do it to some extent. That doesn't mean we're thinking it through. By making these observations, again, it helps us process it so we can picture exactly what's going on here. It's almost like, I'm sorry, I don't want to go off on too much of a tangent. I don't want to steal a show from Jamal. He's doing a great job. But real quick, if it's almost like, when you're putting together furniture, if you get something from IKEA, like if you just kind of read the instructions passively, you're not going to get you're not going to put together the furniture right. But if you sit there and you're like, okay, it's slot A goes into peg B, right? Like, then you have to like sit with it and think it through. And so that's what Jamal's doing here. So, okay, no more blabbering on my part. Jamal, feel free to go on to the next sentence.
Okay. Since mercury that accumulates in a seabird's feathers... All right. Okay. As the feathers grow, is derived from fish eaten by the bird. These results indicate that mercury levels in saltwater fish are higher now than they were 100 years ago.
So if you don't mind, let's just stop and look at that first, not even the first phrase, since mercury, like the first part before that comma, since mercury that accumulates in a seabird's feathers, I just want to point something, right? Jamal was great, right? Like, what do they mean by mercury? Why are they bothering with mercury, right? Like, now we're getting a sense, right? Jamal got curious. He's like asking questions as he's reading, and now we're getting answers to it. That's why they're focusing on mercury, because what did it say? It says, are derived from fish eaten by the bird, right? So does that kind of answer your question before, Jamal, right? Like, that the mercury indicates, right, so they say it's derived from fish eaten by the bird. Is that, how does that sound? Any thoughts?
Sounds pretty good. I think they're making some jumps, but that's probably what every question does.
Yeah, no, and good point. Like, the reason we're looking out for this, great observation, Jamal, like, they're making jumps. And the question is whether these jumps flow logically or are they based on assumptions that they're overlooking. It's a good thing to be on the lookout for, right? So, yeah, since mercury that accumulates in a seabird's feathers, as feathers grow, is derived from fishing by the bird. Okay, great. So then what does the next part say again, these results?
Indicate that mercury levels in saltwater fish are higher now than they were 100 years ago.
Okay, now, right, is there a jump there?
Yes. They're cool. Jumping. Oh, okay. Yes.
No, go ahead. You're doing good.
From what I can see thus far, they're jumping from mercury levels of the specific type that the seabirds eat to an overgeneralization of all saltwater fish.
Yeah. Yeah, excellent. Excellent observation, Jamal. So, like, Jamal intuitively made some great choices. Like, he noticed early on they're talking about these seabirds from different times. Then they're going to their feathers. And then they're talking about mercury. And it's like, he's like, hey, why mercury? And it's like, all right, they're making some jumps, but I guess I kind of see it, right? Mercury, seabirds, feathers, great. And then all of a sudden they go to the saltwater fish. And like you're saying, Jamal, they're making these jumps, and I guess one of the things we want to say is, well, they do two things, right? The jumps can confuse us, or we could overlook them if we're not reading carefully, but luckily Jamal is reading actively and asking questions, so that's great. But then, like, when we notice these jumps, then we got to, like, be critical. Like, Jamal isn't saying, okay, they're making jumps. All right, now are these jumps founded or not? So, right, they're not just saying that, if I could jump in, they're not just saying that, like, they're not making observations about the birds and the mercury levels just because, you know, just the different birds and the mercury levels in time. But then they're saying the fish, right? They're taking it further. And the more jumps you make, well, the more you got to back it up, right? So we want to be a little critical of this. Are they backing this stuff up? So I'm sorry to throw all that out there, but what are your thoughts, Jamal? Like, does that make sense? Do you have any? Is there any other observations, or is there something you want to emphasize?
No, I think you hit it on the head. Like, those are pretty much the thoughts. My thoughts align up to what you just stated.
Cool, good. And also, like, it's good to have a sense of humor about this, because this could be some crazy stuff. But, like, it makes you a little bit detached, and it makes you a little bit better about it. And you don't get so wound up. And the other thing is, like, that's why we want to ask these questions, right? We want to be like, okay, they're going from seabirds to the 1880s to mercury, now to saltwater fish. And I don't know, again, like, that, if you read this passively and don't ask questions, and maybe you don't have a sense of humor, if you don't have a sense of humor, you can get overwhelmed. If you don't ask questions, then you could completely overlook the fact that they went from seabirds and their feathers to mercury levels to now saltwater fish. So that's why you want to ask questions. And as Jamal's doing, after each like sentence or even parts of sentences, think about it, process it, ask questions to yourself. That way you'll be far less likely to, again, there's a good possibility someone could read this and think that the whole thing's entirely about these seabirds, and it's not. At least not in its entirety. They start making an assumption about saltwater fish. So that's why you want to have this sort of like question going on in your mind of what are they saying here, you know? Because this is some dense stuff. So that being said, Jamal, what would you say is the conclusion here? And if you want to take, I don't mean to put you on the spot, but if you want to take a second and think it through or read through it again, take your time.
Okay. These results indicate the mercury levels in saltwater fish are higher now than they were 100 years ago.
Okay. So they're making all these jumps, not to talk about the birds or their feathers, or even, but the saltwater fish and yes. What their mercury levels are. So from all this, we've decided that the mercury levels in saltwater fish are higher now than they were 100 years ago. Okay. Mm-hmm. Again, I want to hold everyone on their honor to not look at the answer choices, because it's only going to, I promise you, it's not helpful. What are some important assumptions here that need to be made for this argument to be true? You want to make any predictions, Jamal, or just throw out ideas of what are assumptions that they need for this argument to be true?
I guess the one that I might have stated earlier was seabirds are the ones that are eating the saltwater fish.
Cool. Seabirds are the ones that are eating the saltwater fish.
Help me out here.
I think that has, right? I like that. And you know what? All right, I'll help you out. But I think you're doing a good job. That kind of has to be true, right? Because if they're not, you know. Think about the conclusion a little bit. What's the conclusion? The conclusion's about the saltwater fish, right? Okay. Well, I think your guess there is pretty good, right? So we want to make sure it applies. So what else? What else kind of has to happen? They should be eating the saltwater fish. Anything else?
This comparison between now and 100 years ago is kind of interesting.
Yeah. Right.
Yes.
So how can we? What are things that are kind of important about this comparison?
Well,
you can just make guesses. Like, what are things that kind of have to be that are important that need to be true or whatever?
I guess the mercury levels have to be higher now than they were before.
Yeah. Right. Well, I mean, yeah. So like, right. Because I think there's two different ideas here, right? The amount of mercury in the feathers we know are higher,
mm-hmm.
but that doesn't necessarily mean. But they're making a conclusion about the mercury levels in saltwater fish,
mm-hmm.
right? So you're saying that they have to be higher, right? So I think if I'm going to take a guess here, is what you're getting. What are you getting at? I'll ask you. What are you getting at? You're saying that the mercury, because there's mercury levels in the feathers, we know that they're higher, but mm-hmm. what mercury levels are you talking about that have to be higher?
I guess in the seabirds. I guess that's maybe the gap that we're trying to fill here.
Well, no, we know. Good. We know. I mean, it states explicitly that at least in their feathers, right? Mm-hmm. The mercury level in the feathers are lower in the stuffed seabirds in the 1880s
mm-hmm.
compared to the feathers of seabirds now. But they drew a conclusion. What's the conclusion they drew?
That because the mercury is higher now, that relates to the levels in saltwater fish being higher as well?
Yeah, exactly. I just want to restate what Jamal says so it's clear. Because there's a difference in the levels of mercury in the feathers of these different birds, you know, in different times, that it indicates a difference in levels of mercury in saltwater fish, right? So there's that. That's quite a jump. So, yeah, anyone else? No, I want to stick with Jamal. You're doing a good job. Any other guess? What has to be true to make this happen? Even just basic stuff. Like, if you were teaching me, would you be like, well, How do we know that this is a how do we know that this indication of like the mercury in the feathers tells us this about saltwater fish? Like, what are your thoughts? Like,
what, I guess the however we tested it had to be consistent, no?
It has to be consistent, right? That's true. I'm going to take it a step further. I'm going to jump a little bit and take it a step further. Like, for whatever reason, I think this is what you're getting at. Like, the proportion of mercury in fish has to be directly proportional to, in some sense, the mercury in these feathers of these seabirds. And the fact that 100 years, nothing's changed, like, that's not going to mess it up. But the fact that there's... Another thing is, right, what's the difference? Some the ones in the 1880s are stuffed, right? So that didn't change. That didn't mess with it. I think that's a fair prediction you could make if this holds true. I don't know, say the digestion, the way that these birds digest hasn't changed. Maybe in the 1880s they would digest so that, I don't know, I hate to be graphic, maybe in the 1880s, they would poop out more of the mercury. That's a possibility. And so, yeah, you wouldn't see as much of the mercury in their feathers. Whereas now, they put the mercury in their feathers more. That doesn't necessarily mean that the mercury that was in the fish changed. Is that fair? Does that make sense, Jamal?
No, that makes sense.
Cool. So basically what we want to see is, like, ideally, that this difference in indication, this difference in mercury, is there an indicator of the fish, that it's a fair indicator of the fish. So cool, I think I like your predictions. I think that's going to put us in a good place as we look through these. So Jamal, do you want to stick with me? Let's stick with me as we go through the answer choices. So what's our strategy again, Jamal, to evaluate these answer choices? What's our litmus test?
We are going to negate each answer choice.
Okay, just ask the question. If you want to negate A, would you say that the proportion of a seabird's diet consisting of fish just as high on average in the 1880s? If that's the case, then it can't be because of the amount of fish they ate. Correct. Let me think. Jamal, would you read A out loud?
The proportion of a seabird's diet consisting of fish was not as high on average in the 1880s as it is today. Should I negate it?
Yeah, let's negate it. So, okay. How would you negate it? Practical.
Practical. Like the example that you used earlier.
Sure.
Is what you're looking for?
What do you mean, that I used or that Mitzi used? Or
The example where we use a real life, I guess, comparison.
Sure, yeah.
Okay. Let's see. The proportion of a seabird's diet consisting of fish was equal to.
Yeah, and that's kind of what Mitzi says, right? It's just as high, because that would be at least an example of something that is different from what A is saying. Mm-hmm. So if we may say that they were equal in proportion, does that make the argument fall apart? If they had the same proportion of fish in the seabird's diet, does that make the argument fall apart? What's the argument again? The argument is that there's more mercury in saltwater fish than 100 years ago.
Yes.
So does that make the argument fall apart?
I don't think so.
Yeah. And Mitzi, it's okay. I think you were saying it does, it doesn't. Let's think about why. Like, let's say they're eating the same amount of fish.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I mean, there could still be other factors. I'm not completely convinced about this argument, but if anything, that might help the argument. Because if they're eating the same proportion of fish, I mean, that's one. And all of a sudden the mercury levels. Well, they're eating the same proportion of fish. I mean, you could say, well, hey, we're controlling for one of these factors, and maybe the fish just have like more mercury now because we're eating the same proportion of fish, but all of a sudden we're getting more mercury in these birds' feathers. So I think it's fair to say that A if you negate it, it doesn't destroy the argument. So as we move on to B, I want to give someone else an opportunity to jump in and work with us. And Jamal, I love your work. If no one is it, I'm going to do this voluntarily. Does anyone want to try for B? I just don't want to give Jamal all the fun.
Thank you.
Yeah, no problem. But wait, you're not off yet. We need a volunteer. I'm going to see if we can actually get a volunteer. Anybody who wants to jump in and do B with me? All right, Mitzi. We're going to have Mitzi do B. Jamal, thank you. You've been doing great, and I appreciate the work.
Thank you.
My pleasure.
Great work, Jamal. Snaps, claps, and everything. I can't unmute everybody here, but Mitzi, can you unmute yourself?
Thanks again, Jamal. I really loved your work. No need to thank us for being patient, Jamal. You did excellent work. We didn't have to be patient. You were wonderful.
I guess again, maybe you can try, Jimmy, to unmute Mitzi. I'll try to
unmute Mitzi here.
You just click your mic button wherever you are.
I'm clicking her mic button. I'm not. Let me see. Did I do it?
Really?
Yeah. Let me.
Mitzi. Go. Yeah, there you go. There you go, Mitzi.
Was that me or you, Mitzi? Just so I know. But did it?
I did it.
Maybe it was.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
All right. So thank you for joining us. So Mitzi, okay, would you be out loud?
Yeah, are we starting with answer choice B or?
Yep, we just did A, so now we're going to do B.
Okay, so B says the amount of mercury in a saltwater fish depends on the amount of pollution in the ocean habitat of the fish.
Okay, so let's, again, I like, you know, essentially, I just want to jump in here for a second. Essentially, we are looking for the logical opposite, but that can throw people off a little bit sometimes. So I think the best way to do that is just think of an example where it's not true. So Mitzi, can you give us an example, any example, where that wouldn't be true, an example of B not being true?
Okay, so the amount of mercury in a saltwater fish depends on, I mean, the way I would attack it, I would just say it's not the case that the amount of mercury in a saltwater fish depends on the amount of pollution in the ocean habitat of the fish. So it's not related to the pollution.
Yeah, right? So, like, let's just say it's not. Let's say it has nothing to do with the pollution.
The case, then it doesn't knock the argument.
Yeah. And one of the reasons is, I mean, they don't even talk about pollution. I mean, we could argue that mercury is a sign of pollution. But they don't mention the word pollution, and it doesn't, I mean, even if we did, it doesn't necessarily do anything with the argument. Again, the argument is that the mercury levels are higher in these mm-hmm. fish. They could be higher from something other than pollution. But maybe they are due to pollution, but it's not proportional. I think it's fair to say that B does not, if you negate B, it doesn't fall apart. So it's not a necessary assumption. Is that fair?
Fair.
Beautiful. Well, I got you here. Let's do C together. Would you read what C says?
Sure. C, mercury derived from fish is essential for the normal growth of a seabird's feathers. When I'm looking at answer choice C, I just see growth pops out, and I just think that that's not relevant to what's stated in the stimulus.
Yeah, I mean, maybe it is, maybe it isn't.
If you wanted to negate it, I guess you would say that mercury derived from fish is not essential for the normal growth of a seabird's feathers, right?
Yeah. And let's say it isn't. Let's say it's not essential. Like, great example. Let's say it doesn't make any difference in the growth of its feathers.
Mm-hmm.
Well, does that change the argument? Does that alter the – does that make the argument fall apart?
If we negate it?
Yeah.
No.
No, I mean, it doesn't really help or hurt, you know, it is what it is.
Yeah.
Let's see, let's do D together. What does D say?
The The stuffed seabirds whose feathers were tested for mercury were not fully grown.
Okay. Stuffed seabirds, right? So let's say they, let's give an example of the opposite.
So the stuffed seabirds whose feathers were tested for mercury were fully grown.
Okay, they were fully grown. So would this affect the argument?
Fall apart? Well, if they were fully grown 100 years ago, then what are you, then you can't really compare. There's no difference because they're exactly the same as they were 100 years ago, correct?
Yeah, but remember, we're comparing the ones from 100 years ago to ones now.
I know, but what I'm saying is that if they were fully grown, right? So if I'm negating D, and we're comparing birds 100 years ago with fully grown feathers to the ones today, then there's no difference, right?
Well, maybe. Go ahead, sorry.
No, maybe I'm not stating that clearly. I don't know, or maybe the way I'm thinking about it isn't correct.
I don't know. I just want to clarify what you're saying so we're all clear on it. Right? You're saying if they're fully grown now, right? Excuse me, the ones from 100 years ago, the stuffed ones are fully grown. Right? Mm-hmm. We're still making the comparison to ones now. We don't necessarily know if the ones now are fully grown or not. Right? Like, they don't say, they're just talking about the stuffed ones from back in the day, from the 1880s. Because the ones now are not stuffed. They're it doesn't say they're stuffed. They just say, birds of the same, living, no, they're not stuffed. The ones from today are living. We don't necessarily know if the ones from living are all fully grown. But let's say we're comparing ones that are fully grown and they've only got half the amount of mercury as ones that are fully grown and not fully grown. The point is they still, even fully grown ones that have more like area, that they're bigger, you know, that they're just generally fully grown. I mean, they have 50% less mercury. So it may not make it, even if proportionally the ones from now like evolved to be even bigger. The point is it doesn't really, does it make a difference in the argument? Does it destroy the argument?
No.
No, I don't think it does. Like, it could or it couldn't, but we don't know. Again, destroying the argument means that it's just done, that it's not, that it's just destroyed. The argument falls apart. I mean, if we really change circumstances, maybe, maybe not, but it doesn't make the argument fall apart. So what do you think? Is D our answer or no? Can we eliminate
no.
D? Yeah, we can eliminate. It's not our answer.
I guess it's also important to note, like, for the ones that you do negate, if nothing, I guess, if you don't see it fall apart, like if it doesn't do anything, then that obviously can't be the answer choice.
Yeah, if it doesn't do anything, and even now, like for this one, maybe we could rationalize, but it could help, or it could, like, if you have to add extra stuff to maybe make it do something, that doesn't mean the argument falls apart. You need something where just the opposite, or an example of an opposite, makes the argument fall apart. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Cool. Are we good to move to E?
Sure.
All right. So what does E say?
The process used to preserve birds in the 1880s did not substantially decrease the amount of mercury in the bird's feathers.
Okay. This is very lawyer-like language here. So you want to maybe translate that to English for us? Paraphrase it for us?
Sure. So whatever process they used in the 1880s didn't decrease the amount of mercury in birds.
Okay. Cool. Now, what would be an example of the opposite?
The process used substantially decreased the amount of mercury in the bird's feathers. So it was really the process.
Yeah, and when we say preserve birds, what do we mean by preserve? What, does they refer to anything that goes on in the stimulus? What do they mean by preserve?
I don't know. Help me out with this one.
Sure. I'm trying to just clarify her. I'm not trying to put you on the spot, but I just want to make clear, right? The 1880s, those birds are stuffed, right? So, you know, I think they don't want to say stuff because that would make it too easy. But it's the same thing. It's just a synonym. They're just taking it a step further. By stuffing the birds, the process of stuffing the birds or preserving them, didn't substantially decrease the amount. So if we make that false, so if we say, hey, by stuffing these birds, you lowered the amount of mercury in the feathers, right? Well, remember, that was a key difference, as Jamal pointed out, between the birds in the 1880s and the ones now. The ones now are alive. The ones back then are stuffed or preserved, right? So let's say this thing is true. Let's negate E, meaning that, hey, well, if you're going to stuff these birds, that means that you're going to lower the amount of mercury in their feathers. What does that do to this argument?
Well, then it makes the argument fall apart, because then it can't be from the fish that they ate. It's actually stuffing process that they had.
Yeah, I mean, who knows? If we really want to be over-analytical about it, maybe the fish contributed. But it's not like just... But we cannot soundly say, hey, look, the amount of mercury in these feathers are lower. So, man, it's those fish. They got more mercury. That'd be crazy, because the process of stuffing them lowers the mercury levels. So that does make the argument fall apart. Does that make sense?
Yes.
So would you say that E's our answer?
Yes.
Excellent. And listen, I'm sorry, I'm seeing some of these comments. So we're all clear that stuffing is preserving, right? I hope. If you're not, you can send out a message. But does this all make sense, Mitzi, since you're working with me? Do you get why E is the answer?
Yeah. I think it's also important to know. I mean, I've been tackling this LSAT for a while now, but I notice, like, when I think too critically about the question or the answer choices, sometimes I get a little confused with it. I think if you dive too deep, you might confuse yourself, if that makes sense.
I hope I did. By the way, I want to say I hope I didn't confuse anybody when I would try to, like, anticipate potential questions like the difference between preserved and stuffed. But I do want to say you're right, Mitzi. I like your observation. If I could just, this might be helpful. In a way, you kind of have to overanalyze for the LSAT. The question isn't whether you think or rationalize. The question is whether you're rationalizing on what you're supposed to be thinking about. You know, like overthinking about things that are not related is a bad thing. But thinking in an intense way about the things that are related, that's a good thing. So it's almost like targeted thinking. Does that make sense? Does that put it in perspective?
Yeah, no, it does. Also, I have a quick question. I know that Jay teaches a lot of, and this might not be for this class, maybe for another one, maybe for like an advanced NA course, but he does like break down the stimulus into logic. And I'm wondering, and I can't remember if, like, we should be doing this for NA questions or SA questions, but if we have to do it for, like, the more difficult NA questions, that, or how do we know when it's appropriate to do it and when it's not?
I'll throw in a little 2 cents here just to give Jimmy just a breath, because he's been talking a lot. I would say that one way you want to think about diagramming and all that logic is it's a tool. If it helps you come to the right answer, then yeah, use it. But I don't think it's a necessary, nor is it a sufficient condition to getting the right answer. All it is is the symbolism, like the writing down of things. It's just a shorthand. It's a way to codify it in a very simple, easy way. But if you can see that, you don't need necessarily to use the logic. It's only there as a learning tool. And I know, you know, case in point, if by chance you ever get to like PT, when you get to PT 69, you're going to find JY has a video of every question he has done in real time. And I think only like one or two actual questions does he actually write out any sort of logic. He's doing it all in his head, so it's all intuitive. Now, by all means, when you're blind reviewing, when you're working through it, absolutely, write out all that logic. Practice that so that it becomes an intuition. But so that's my 2 cents. I'm sure Jimmy has his own answer. I just wanted to give him a little bit of a break to, because I know he's been on for a while.
Oh no, thank you, Dave. I think Dave made a great point. I just want to again, and I would say I agree with exactly what Dave said. A lot of people ask about when to diagram, when not to diagram, and I think you get a feel for it. And I think Dave gave a great way of thinking about it. And it's what I do. It's like when it's helpful to me, I do it. When it's not, I don't. If it's gonna take, this is a good way of thinking about it. If it's going, are you still here with me, Mitzi?
Yeah, I'm still here.
If it's gonna take more work and more time to diagram, and that doesn't mean that. Well, there's a caveat to that. Like if you haven't learned how to diagram, then of course it's gonna take more work and time. But when you're okay on diagramming, and you know how to do it, if it's gonna take more time and work and effort to diagram, then maybe that's an indication that you shouldn't diagram. But if it's helpful to you, if it's gonna take these complex terms and deduce them to like just simple players where you have like a letter representing something and then the symbols, and it gets you past all the stuff that's gonna trip you up, that's when it's great to diagram.
It's a cliche, but like learn the rules before you break them.
Yeah, there you go. And I think like you said, Dave, it's a tool, and it's like you use it when it serves you well. You use it when it simplifies things, and you don't use it when it's not necessary and you could get it on its own without it. If that makes any sense. If it makes it better, then use it. If it's not necessary, then I would. If that makes any sense. And let me just clarify, were you even talking about diagramming, or are you talking about just in general, like maybe having letters that represent things and drawing it out? Because I will say, I apologize on the short notice, I'm a little hampered without the tools so that I could maybe draw stuff in front of you. Maybe, I don't know if I have that ability with GoToMeeting. Certainly when I do stuff in the future, even if there's no need to diagram, I'll probably have the ability to write stuff so it's clearer. Did you mean diagramming, Mitzi? Is that what you were referring to?
Yeah, I meant diagramming, and I guess when I first started Seven Sage, like when I was watching the videos, like he pretty much diagrammed all of the questions, so I guess I just assumed that like this is the approach I need to take. But you know, these two questions we did here, I mean, I just read it and I came to the correct answer choice just by reading it. So, but I have also come across, you know, other necessary assumption questions with tougher language in there, and I'm just wondering, like, for those who've gotten the correct answer choice for those, if they've diagrammed or they just, you know, read and think about it.
Sure. No, great point. I will say, I look at this one, and I don't know. I mean, there are some keywords here, like only, but I don't know if this one lends itself as much to strict diagramming, because the concepts are a bit more, the concepts don't translate to me as well to diagramming. I think they're a little more, they're a little more abstract. Maybe it's not the best word for it. I just don't think practically it were these, for me at least, where I think these are things that are like, maybe it's better just to kind of picture. But if we get one, I think just
that
totally
works diagram.
Yeah. And by the way, no matter what level you're in, like I wanted to say to everyone, like maybe we could do a lesson on diagramming at some point. I think that would be a good thing. But you definitely learn diagramming. Definitely, diagramming is one of those things where you kind of think you know it. You probably still need to go over a little more. Jay White has a great way of breaking things down, particularly in the groups 1 through 4. So definitely review them. Make sure you know them. But you ideally want to get to a place where you're like, you know it enough, and you'll be able to say, hey, is this going to make my life easier or harder? And that, if that makes any sense.
Yeah.
Cool. If there aren't, I see that there might be an interest in, I really would like that diagramming the necessary assumption. Simo, would you want to clarify?
We'll put that in the schedule. We'll stick with necessary assumptions for this one, but yeah, we'll definitely have we'll just diagram away. There's plenty of apps we can do for that and put it on there. We'll have something great lined up. If not, you know, and next week, maybe in the week after that.
Yeah. Oh, and Amy, thank you for the reminder. Amy, do you have to go, or can I do it after our next question? Because I do want to talk about skipping. But I just want to make sure we get through.
Yeah, go, dude, whatever you want to do. Yeah, answer the question. That'd be great.
Okay, cool. Amy said Amy can wait till the next question. Until after we don't. So we will talk about skipping. That's something. By the way, I want to. Oh, we're gonna do the next question, and then I know we've been going for over 2 hours here. I don't want to waste everyone's time. So after that, if you guys want to,
you're not, dude.
General, okay, cool. But after that next question, maybe we can open it up to some Q&A about anything. Is that okay, David?
That's awesome, man. You are. This is your domain. You're doing great.
I just want to make sure that we've given enough of a treatment on Unnecessary Assumption.
So, I mean, we can do a Q&A, and if we want to spontaneously do another question because something comes up from the Q&A, that's cool too.
Okay, cool. So let me see here. We want to next go to question 17. Can everyone see it? I don't know how my screen is appearing. And David, maybe you could help me out.
I missed that last part you said. What?
I want to make sure my screen is right. Are we on question 17? Can everyone see?
Oh, yes. No, I see question 11.
Okay. Is there a way that I can adjust my screen so it goes to, you know how I can adjust my screen so it goes to 11?
That's weird. I don't know why that would be the case. Let me see here. Did you push like a screen lock button or anything like that?
I don't know. I might have not. Really.
What I would do is, you know, it's always a good idea is just to let go of anything. Like, you know, just take off the press the play button again to turn it off, and then turn it back on, and maybe that will fix things.
Okay. All right. How about now?
Yeah, I mean, Missy's right, too. We can just look at it, but
I don't want to make you all look up the PDF.
Yeah, I am sorry. I don't see it. I don't see what's going on. Like I said, we were going to have technical difficulties, but like I said, everyone should have an copy of this. This was hopefully the first thing they took, the first practice.
Tyler, you see it? You guys see
it? Oh, no, there it is. We see it now. We got it.
Do you guys see my camera, or am I off?
What?
You guys see my camera, or is that off?
No, we just see the screen, your screen.
Okay, cool, that's all we need. I can make funny faces, goof off, and you guys won't even know. Let's just go to, we'll stick with the screen. The cool thing about this, I think now the way it's working is I can focus on just the question, right? You guys just see 17?
Well, we see A, B, and the first line of C.
Okay. That doesn't matter. Just try to avoid looking at the question types, looking at the answer choices. All right, cool. Let's move forward. So can we get a volunteer to read? So if anyone wants to read, just jump in the chat room.
We'll call on you. It's good for you. It's good for you to suck at this. It really is. Why don't we hear from somebody we haven't seen? Seema. Seema Karimi. Why don't we? Why don't you unmute yourself and we'll just throw it. I know Jimmy's being nice and not wanting you, but no, if you're here, I told you this was going to be interactive, and it's really important. There you go. Seema is.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can. How you doing?
I'm good. I haven't gotten to Necessary Assumptions in my curriculum yet, so I'm probably way behind all of you guys. But I can read the stimulus if you like.
Let me ask you real quick. Were you with us from the beginning?
No, I just jumped in. I thought it was 1 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. I got the last part of the last question, last question answer choice.
I'll tell you what, Seema. I'm really glad that you're jumping in, even though you missed the first part. But let me just real quick, and I think this will help some people that might have missed a few things. Real quick, the deal with with necessary assumption. By the way, we want to look for keywords. So just the fact that there's a word assumption isn't enough. You want to look for in the question, right? You want to look for words like depends, relies, requires, necessary. If you see any of those four words. And you know, maybe afterwards I'll send the text to you just so you have it. If you see any of those four words, it indicates to you that it is a necessary assumption question. And then you're in a good place because you don't have to – then you can be like, oh, great, I know it's a necessary assumption question. So I go to my necessary assumption strategy. And then real quick, because I think that repeating things can help everyone, the nature of these are such that, like, for the argument to be true, this assumption has to be true. This assumption is required. So without it, without that assumption, it falls apart. And the example I gave, Seema, was if I said, okay, I'm gonna pick you up at your house in 30 minutes. I'm gonna drive to pick you up at your house in 30 minutes. Like, the assumptions that for that to be true are almost kind of annoying in a way. But it's like okay, like, you know, oh, well, Jimmy knows how to drive, right? If I say I'm going to drive and pick you up, well, we have to assume I know how to drive, because if I didn't, I probably wouldn't be able to drive and pick you up. We have to assume I have enough fuel, right? So it's these really annoying, like, low-floor assumptions. And then just for our strategy, the way we know, we want to make predictions of what they are before we get to the answer choices. I'm going to be doing that with you. The other thing is we want to negate the answer choice. Because if you negate the answer choice and the argument falls apart, that means that assumption was required. I just threw a lot at you. It may not be gelling, but it's okay. We'll do this together. I think it's a good way to start to learn and jump in. So don't sweat if you didn't get everything I threw at you. We'll do this together, and it'll help everybody. Is that cool?
Yeah, actually, the part that I'm frustrated most with necessary question types are negating the answer choices. That's the part that I get really confused with.
Cool. So, I'll you know what? I'll keep you going with me through as we do a few of the answer choices. Normally I split it up, but I'll have you at least do A and B with me, and I'll show you exactly what we're talking about. And hopefully it'll help anyone else out there that's struggling. So, would you read the question itself for me?
Which one of the following is an assumption required by the argument?
Cool. So again, I don't know if you remember what I said before, right? We got the word assumption there. So then it could be a sufficient assumption question or a necessary assumption question. But the fact that we see the word required tells us that it is a necessary assumption question. Is that cool?
Yeah.
Cool. And again, there are four. Required, as I said before, necessary, depends, and relies. I will send them to you, or maybe someone can send them to you afterwards just to make sure you have them. But as long as you see one of those four with the word assumption, that tells you that it is a necessary assumption question. Is that cool?
Yeah.
All right. So then go ahead and read the stimulus.
Okay. When exercising the muscles in one's back, it is important in order to maintain a healthy back to exercise the muscles on opposite sides of the spine equally. After all, balanced muscle development is needed to maintain a healthy back, since muscles on opposite sides of the spine must pull equally in opposing directions to keep the back in proper alignment and protect the spine.
Okay, cool. So, I want you to read this again.
Okay.
And the reason I want you to read it again is, it's okay, you missed as we were doing some of these. You're not going to be able, obviously not going to be able to read these out loud, but I want you to sort of replicate what we're going to do. It's like, if you just read through it, you may not get every important point. So I almost want you to, like, kind of stop as you're reading, maybe after every comma or so, and just make sure we got everything. Like, maybe paraphrase yourself so we're clear on it. So let's start over. So from the beginning, go ahead.
So just pause after every comma.
Yeah, let me say this. A comma is a good checkpoint to make sure you got it. So maybe the first comma isn't perfect, but like maybe after. Like, see and make sure if there's something, if there's a lot going on there. If it says something that's pretty basic and you just get it automatically, don't worry about it. But if you get to a comma and you're like, huh, let me just make sure I got this, that's when I want you to really stop and we'll think about it. Cool.
And I'm thinking globally, if those of you who were in the active reading workshop on Wednesday, remember this was something like Corey was talking about by putting that vertical line down, just to help you stop so that you really actively think about what you're doing. You see, all the top scorers do this, even if they don't know they have just different ways of saying it. But this is my whole posit, is that it's all about how good of a reader you are. Great habit. Thank you. Just wanted to... No, throw that in there and let you go back to it.
Yeah. So, I mean, one thing, by the way, I want to say this. The reason we're doing this, I think this is what Dave was saying, is, like, Dave was getting at is, like, this is complex stuff. And if you just kind of read it on autopilot, like, we could all just kind of read it. But you want to make sure you process it. Like, even a seemingly simple thing, you want to be like, wait a minute. You almost want to stop it and visualize it and be like, it's like your the example I gave before was if you're putting together furniture from IKEA. If you just read the instructions blindly, you're not going to get it. Like, you really want to be like, okay, if it says insert portion B into slot C, like, you want to pick up the pieces and sort of picture it. And that's kind of metaphorically what we're doing by stopping and making sure we get everything. So, Seema, just read up to where it's, like, getting a little, maybe not the first comma, but maybe the second. Or if you want the first comma. But commas are often a good checkpoint. Okay. But just give it a go.
Okay. When exercising the muscles in one's back, it is important in order to maintain a healthy back.
All right, let's stop here for a minute. What are they saying?
They're saying when you exercise the muscles in your back, it's important. I think there's another idea coming because...
Something, right? They're going to lead into something.
Yeah.
And in order to maintain a healthy back, right? So whatever they're going to tell you is important to maintain a healthy back.
Yeah.
Well, okay, I'm sorry. I hope I didn't stop you too prematurely, but go ahead.
No. Okay, to exercise the muscles on opposite sides of the spine equally.
Okay,
so
No, I'm interrupting you. I'm sorry. What do they mean?
What I think they're saying is in order to maintain a healthy back, you need to exercise the muscles on opposite sides of the spine equally.
Okay.
But what does that mean, exercising the muscles on opposite sides of the spine equally?
Good question. So, like, we can make predictions as we know, like, I don't know, like, Seema, do you exercise?
Yeah, I do.
Oh, you do lift weights at all?
Not really, sometimes.
But even if you've done it before, right? Let's take the back. The back may not work visually. But see, by the way, the process that we're going through right now, I think, is a good thing. Like, even if I'm not here doing this test with you, you want to do this with yourself. You want to kind of visualize it and think about it, right? So, have you ever, like, even if you haven't done it often, if you, like, exercise with free weights or, like, dumbbells, maybe, like, doing bicep curls ever?
Yeah.
Right? So, I'm going to guess that if you do bicep curls for one arm, if you do 10 for one arm, you probably want to do 10 for the other. Is that fair?
Yeah.
So I think, right, like, it's almost like there are two sides to your back. So maybe you're doing something, like, with one arm that helps your back. Maybe is it fair to say that they're probably saying, hey, if you're doing 10 reps for the side, for one side of your back, you want to do 10 reps for the side for the other. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does.
And if you look at the phrasing, in order to maintain a healthy back.
Yeah.
All right, cool. So see what we're doing, though? As we're reading, we're stopping to visualize it. If there's something we're uncertain about, like, I like the fact that you said, hey, what do they mean here? And then you kind of figure it out. You're maybe using other examples. That's what you want to do.
Yeah.
Is that cool?
Mm-hmm.
All right. So what's next?
After all, balanced muscle development is needed to maintain a healthy back.
Okay. So again, we're going back to healthy back, and what do they say is needed to maintain a healthy back?
Balanced muscle development.
So somehow this idea of, I don't want to draw the conclusion for you, but it seems like I might be, somehow what we're talking about in one, like exercising both of them equally, is going to balance muscle development, which you need for a healthy back. Is that fair?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. And then feel free to go further.
Okay, since the muscles on opposite sides of the spine must pull equally in opposing directions to keep the back in proper alignment and protect the spine. So I think the part where they're saying since, that's kind of introducing support for the balanced muscle development.
Yeah, I think they might, do you think they're making a jump here or is it just me?
Let me look at it again to myself really quick. Yeah, they are making a jump because they're talking about keeping the back in proper alignment and protecting the spine, whereas the main idea is about maintaining a healthy back and balanced muscle development.
Yeah, I want to point something else out that they do. If you guys notice, they're throwing a lot in that last sentence. They're throwing a lot out here. These muscles on opposite sides of the spine must pull equally, and then not just pull equally, but in opposing directions. So trying to picture this is a lot. To keep the back in proper alignment and protect the spine. Now there's all this stuff they're throwing out here. So you can get muddied into the details, and I mean, it's not a bad thing to try to visualize this, But I'm gonna jump out on a limb here, and I'm gonna say, all right, let's just say this is like, I might even, if it were me on the test, I might just circle this whole phrase after since, and I'll just label it as something like D or F or number one or seven. Because the point is, it doesn't matter what they're saying. They're using all these words to throw you off. But it's all like one lump thing that they're getting at, that they're saying this needs to happen. And these other things you do, like exercising equally on both sides, is going to cause this to happen, which is needed. Does that make sense a little bit?
Yeah.
Like the whole idea of like equally pulling in opposing directions, like you can analyze it, but the point is whatever this phrase is here, this is what you're going to achieve by exercising equal, which apparently is needed for maintaining a healthy back. Is that fair?
Yeah.
All right. So again, we don't have to like master all the details. We just need to know the big picture stuff. But what would you say is the main conclusion of this argument? You could pick it in a phrase or whatever.
I could be wrong, but I think the main conclusion is that in order to maintain a healthy back, you need to exercise muscles on opposite sides equally, and in order to do that, you have to have balanced muscle development. I don't know. I could be totally wrong.
You're good. You're good. I could be wrong here, but I think you could. If we just want to isolate the main conclusion.
Right.
I think we could just say that it's in order to maintain a healthy back, you must, or it is important to exercise the muscles on opposite sides of the spine equally. And that's it. I think that because that is ultimately what they're getting at. The other stuff serves to support it, right? Mm-hmm. I like that you were talking about the balanced muscle development, but that's sort of a premise. That's sort of an explaining why, you know, you need to go opposite side. At the end of the day, the bottom line is, yes, it leads to development. But the point is that, right, the development, I think, Tyler, I think you're right, that's sort of an intermediate conclusion. I mean, I don't think we need to split too many hairs over whether we should include that or not. I think you might be fine on that, Seema. But at the very least, you want to include the idea that you need to exercise both sides of the back equally, the muscles on both sides of the back equally. Are we all okay on that?
Yeah, I am.
All right, you are? Okay, cool. If anyone isn't, let me know. Tyler, I think you're right about the whole intermediate conclusion, but at the very least, we just need, for our purposes here, the overall conclusion is isolating muscles on both sides, exercising muscles on opposite sides of the spine equally is important to maintain a healthy back. So we need to know the conclusion, to understand the argument, right? And as you all know, and I know you didn't catch all of this, Seema, but then our rule for this is, first let's make some predictions. I don't want to get too much into this because we're running out of time. We've kept people for a long while here. But let's make some predictions. What are things that are needed for this whole idea to be true? Why do you need to exercise muscles on both sides of your back?
So your back stays healthy?
Okay, so your back stays healthy. What has to be true? What are assumptions that have to be true?
Your muscles have to be strong enough to be able to pull on opposite sides.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, cool. Yeah, so you need stronger muscles, and in turn, exercising them equally are going to lead to stronger muscles. So I think that's fair. Okay, cool. Again, in the interest of time, normally I'd say, hey, we can throw out some more, but I think at this point, let's just move to the answer choices, and we'll practice negating them to see if the argument falls apart. Again, the argument falling apart would mean that, you know, again, our argument is that we, in order to maintain a healthy back, we have to exercise muscles on opposite sides equally. So let's see if we can make that fall apart by negating any of these. So A, what does A say?
Do you want me to read it or try to negate it?
Read it first.
Okay. Muscles on opposite side of the spine that are equally well developed will be enough to keep the back in proper alignment.
Okay. So muscles on opposite sides of the spine that are equally well developed. What if you were to negate that? How would you negate that?
Maybe you would say will not necessarily be enough. Or might not be enough.
Or this is good to good, right? So this is what you were wondering about. I think practically for our purposes here, right? I think what you're saying is fine for all these. I say just to make it easier, just choose an example that would qualify as an opposite. Or is it, you know what I'm saying, is a negation. So here, equally well-developed would be enough to keep the back in proper alignment. Let's mm-hmm. just say, give me an example of something that would be a negation of this. Just one example.
According to the LSAT negation, or just negation in general?
Just in general, like something that's okay. something that is not true, not an example of this, something that is not an example of this.
So maybe muscles on opposite sides of the spine that are not equally well developed, so they're disproportionate to each other?
And what about them?
So because they're disproportionate, it's not enough to keep the back in proper alignment. And they're not, maybe they're not, well, yeah, I guess it would be disproportionate, or they're not well developed. So maybe one muscle on one side of the back is really weak and the other one is okay. It's not strong, but it's okay.
So essentially they're not equally developed.
Yeah.
And would that make it, what are you saying about them? Would that be enough to keep?
I'm saying that won't be enough.
It won't be enough.
Back.
So, I don't know. I'm a little off on this one because it is sort of a different animal. Well, let's do this for our purpose, okay. to keep it simple. Let's say muscles on opposite sides of the spine that are equally well developed are not enough to keep mm-hmm. the back in proper alignment. Are not enough. All right. I mean, like, this is not what they're saying, right? So it would count as an example of a negation. They're not enough. So yeah. Let's say they're not enough to keep the back in proper alignment. Did they say anything about alignment in any of this?
No.
Yeah, so does this make the argument fall apart?
No.
So right, it doesn't meet our litmus test. We want something where if we had an example of a negation, it would make the argument fall apart.
Yeah.
So even if we did the original one you said, I don't think it would make any difference because we're not talking about proper alignment.
Yeah. When you see this answer choice, if you were doing it in real time, I mean, I won't be doing tests in real time at least till February, but if you were to see it in real time, would you just look at the word proper alignment and say, oh, that's new information, and just eliminate it based on that?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a fair one. Not being relevant is fair. That's an easy one. Yeah, like Laura said, it doesn't talk about it at all. So that's a good way of saying, well, shoot, that doesn't even apply. So, yeah, that's a good – I mean, I don't want to take anything for granted, but that's a good indication that it's
– Oh, they're saying in the comments that they do talk about proper alignment, and they do in the last premise.
Maybe we're missing something. Where do they talk about alignment?
Since it says – the muscles on opposite sides of the spine must pull equally in opposing directions to keep the back in proper alignment. But that's not the conclusion, right?
You guys were right. I was wrong. My apologies. Thank you. All right, let's think about this then. So since muscles on the opposite side of the spine must equally to keep the spine alignment and protect the spine in proper alignment. Okay, so let's look at A again with fresh eyes. Equally developed be enough to keep the back in proper alignment. Okay. So let's use your other example. Your example was, let's say they're not, what did you say? What was the first one you said?
I said that the muscles on each side are, one is disproportionate to the other, so one could be really weak and one could be not strong enough to allow the spine to be well developed, or keep the back in proper alignment.
I'm sorry, one more time?
Sorry. What I said initially was that the muscles on opposite sides, are both of them are not equally well developed. Like, one could be really weak and the other could be, it could be strong, but it could not be strong enough to keep the back in proper alignment.
Okay. So, if they're find that are equally well developed will be enough to keep the back in proper development. Well, you're saying that they're not enough or they are enough?
They're not enough.
I don't know if that would... This isn't necessarily saying that those aren't true. I think that this is saying that they... Muscles on both sides of the argument. Yeah, what's Missy saying? The stimulus is not saying that exercising has to be enough. Yeah, yeah, I don't think they're saying that it has to be enough. Muscles on opposite sides of the spine that are equally well developed will be enough to keep the. I mean, they're saying that, yeah, it's necessary, but it's not necessarily sufficient. So, there could be other things. If we think about negating it, let's just say there could be other things that are important to keep it aligned.
Yeah. And it says exercise the muscles on the opposite sides of the spine equally. It doesn't say that they both have to be strong muscles.
Yeah, yeah. Like, muscles on opposite sides of the spine, they're equally well developed. Well, yeah, what they are saying is that alone, right, will be enough. Like, yeah. But maybe it's not enough. Maybe there are other things. Enough would guarantee it to keep it in proper alignment, but maybe there are other factors. They're just saying it's necessary. But, great, this one comes down to the difference between necessary and sufficient. So that's why A doesn't quite work, as I think Mitzi's saying.
Why is it? Could you explain it again? Sorry.
So like, muscles on the opposite side of the spine that are equally well-developed will be enough to keep the back in proper alignment, right? So what they're saying, let's take a look at back at what they're saying. Balanced muscle development is needed. Balanced muscle development is needed to maintain a healthy back. It's needed, right? Since since that would keep them, and then it says since the muscles on opposite sides must pull equally to keep them in proper alignment, right? So it's needed. But just because, just right, it's only, it comes down to the age-old question. Something that's necessary isn't always sufficient. Right, so it's like, hey Matt, you know, maybe my muscles on both sides of my back are equally developed, but there might be other. But that doesn't necessarily mean that's going to put my back in proper alignment, right? Like there could be other things that threw my back off alignment. Maybe I got into a car accident and threw my spine off or something. Does that make sense?
Yeah, that makes sense.
That's why, like, if we were negate it, let's negate it, right? Let's just say, okay, they are equally developed, great, but that it's enough to keep the back in proper alignment. Let's just, negating it would mean that it's not enough. All right, well, maybe it's not enough, and maybe you got a car accident, so it's not enough. Great, but that doesn't throw the argument apart. The argument's saying that to maintain a healthy back, exercise, you have to exercise both muscles on the opposite side of the argument, the opposite side of the spine. Like, it doesn't have to be like so that this guarantees equal alignment, that equal development guarantees alignment, if that makes any sense.
Right? Yeah, it does. Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right, it doesn't throw the argument out completely.
Yeah.
This one is a tricky one, so I hope everyone's kind of following along. So let's go to B. What does B say?
Exercising the muscles on opposite sides of the spine unequally tends to lead to unbalanced muscle development.
Ooh, exercising the muscle on opposite sides of the spine unequally. So I don't exercise, I do more on my left side, right? Mm-hmm. Tends to lead to unbalanced muscle development. All right, what would be the opposite of that?
Would you just change the unequally to equally?
Let's think about this more practically.
Okay.
Let's visualize this, right? So let's just say we're still going to do it unequally.
Okay.
We're still exercising unequally. I'm doing 10 reps on my left side and 2 on my right side. Or I just do my left side, don't even bother with my right side. They're saying leads to an unbalanced muscle development. Right? So if I just exercise my left side, I'm going to get unbalanced muscle development, according to B. Now let's say the opposite would be, all right, I could just exercise my left side, not bother with my right, and I'm going to get balanced muscle development. I can get balanced muscle development by just doing my left side. Does that make sense? That would be the opposite.
Okay.
Now, what's if we look at the conclusion, when exercising in muscles in one's back, it is important in order to maintain a healthy back to exercise muscle on opposite sides of the spine equally. Well, hold on a second. We're saying if we don't exercise them equally, if I just exercise my left side, according to B, the negation of B, we'll still have balanced muscle development. But their whole thing is that you need balanced muscle development to maintain a healthy back. So if we negate B, what do you think? Does the argument fall apart?
I think it does.
Okay, I would think so too. What does everybody else think? Mitzi seems to agree. All right, Jamal says yes. Okay, cool. Yes, I'm thinking B might be our answer here. Do you want to go through C, D, and E with me, or should I pick somebody else?
Whatever you like.
Well, I'll tell you what. We're almost done with this, so let's go through this together. Okay. I think it might be good for you because you wanted to work on negating. So what does C say?
I can't see it.
Okay, I'm scrolling up. How about now? You see it now?
No.
No? Weird. Okay, maybe it's my computer.
Is this the June 2007 test? I can look for it on the LSAC website.
Yeah, you know what, though? Because of the time, I don't want to... I'll tell you what, I'll read it to you, and then we can talk.
Okay.
How about you guys? Can you guys see it? Oh, okay. Well, then maybe I should pull it up. I'm sorry, guys. Is Dave still on here, or did he... No, he's not. All right, I wonder what I did.
Somebody posted it.
Thank you, Riju. You're the man. All right. So would you read what Riju posted for C?
Okay. Provided that one exercises the muscles on opposite sides of the spine equally, one will have a generally healthy back.
Okay. So negate that. Give me an example of the opposite. Give me one thing that would... I'll give you a hint, though. Like, let's make it not have a happy... Would you try? Just try to give me an example of something that would be the opposite of C.
Okay, so maybe one person is exercising muscles on opposite sides of the spine equally, and they don't have a healthy back, a generally healthy back. What's a generally healthy back, though? They're just talking about a healthy back. Or am I just overanalyzing the word generally?
It might be. I mean, I think like there could be a few exceptions, but right, like overall, they're probably going to have a healthy back. How's that?
Okay, yeah. Okay.
Maybe it's a key word, so we'll hold that in the back burner. Maybe it'll help us. But so provided that one exercises the muscle on opposite sides of the back equally, one will have a generally healthy back. So what will be a negation of this?
One will not have a generally
healthy back. Yeah, so again, maybe I'm just exercising my left side.
Yeah.
Right? One will generally have a healthy back. But the argument let's see.
Is it because this is talking about this is going to give you a healthy back and the argument's talking about maintaining a healthy back?
No.
No?
No. One exercise the muscles on opposite sides of the back equally, one will have a generally healthy back. You know what? C is an example. So what is the conclusion saying what? The conclusion is saying it is important to maintain the back, it is important in order to maintain.
Oh, it's switching the necessary and sufficient, right?
Yeah. Yep. That's what it's doing. So like it's not like this is gonna guarantee it. It's just that it's necessary. Because again, I could exercise them both equally, but maybe I did other things to mess up my back. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So yeah, this one it is a little tricky, but yeah, it doesn't necessarily make the argument fall apart, right? Like so, let's just say I am exercising on both sides, but I got into a car accident, right? Like I mean, I don't necessarily have to have a healthy back because I'm exercising equally on both sides.
Yeah.
Is that cool?
Uh-huh. Wait, actually, no, I didn't understand the last part. The accident example.
Provided that one exercise the muscle on opposite sides of the spine equally, one will have a generally healthy back. Let's negate it. So let's just say I do exercise equally.
Mm-hmm. I understood the problem with the necessary and sufficient. Yeah. I just didn't understand that. Your car accident example?
Sure. My car accident example was just that, like, I could exercise equally on both sides, but if I get in a car accident, I could have an unhealthy back.
Yeah, like, okay. Okay, yeah, that makes sense.
Okay, cool. So if we're good, let's move on to D. What does D say?
It says, if the muscles on opposite sides of the spine are exercised unequally, one's back will be irreparably damaged.
Okay. They're exercised unequally. So what's the opposite of that?
I guess one's back will not be irreparably damaged.
Okay, cool. Does that do anything for our argument about having to maintain a healthy back?
No, I really do think that irreparably damaged is kind of adding new information because it's taking the stimulus to an extreme.
Yeah, I think that's fair. Yeah, and let's just say they're... Yeah, like... Let's just say we do my example. We're just exercising the left side, not bothering with the right side. And it doesn't make it, you know, irreparably damaged, right? It doesn't necessarily, fine, it's not so we're exercising it unequally. And it doesn't make it irreparably undamaged. That still doesn't mean that I've got a healthy back. Does that make sense? Like, maybe I damage my back irreparably, but I can still have an unhealthy back. It doesn't make our argument fall apart. Is that fair?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, it doesn't address anything about the healthy back.
That's true. Okay, finally, E.
Okay. One should exercise daily to ensure that muscles on opposite sides of the spine keep the back in proper alignment.
Okay, one should exercise daily to ensure that muscles on the opposite side of the spine keep the back in proper alignment. Okay, let's say you don't exercise daily.
Mm-hmm.
And you could still keep your back in proper alignment. Does that mess with the argument? Again, the argument is that you should exercise both sides equally.
No, it doesn't do anything to the argument.
It's not even relevant.
Yeah.
So that's why B is the answer. None of these quite work except for B. Exercising the muscle on opposite sides of the spine unequally tends to lead to unbalanced muscle development. You need to get back, the argument falls apart. That makes sense?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. 17 was a tricky one. And just a heads up, I mean, there's order is important, right? Like, because people think, oh, the last five. It's not necessarily the last five. Like, there's a general increase in difficulty, but it's staggered. Like, I don't know, 14 and 15 could be medium, and then all of a sudden 17 could be crazy hard. So you want to be open to the fact that they could have this stagger spike in the difficulty of something. But good job. Cool. Thank you.
Cool. So well, the last 15 minutes of this, I'd love to just bring out a straight Q&A. And we can do this where, like, you know, you could say hand in the comments, and then he'll call, you know, Jimmy will call, and you can interface with him and ask a question directly rather than having to type it out. So that way you can also counter and have, like, a little bit of a conversation about the whole thing. So.
Cool. You know, if we can, if you don't mind, let's just go to Amy first. I know she's been patient. Is Amy around? Skipping questions, please. Okay, cool. So, Dave, should I just answer her question, or should I open her up on the mic, or?
However you want to do it. Yeah, I mean, Amy, you can definitely unmute yourself, or Jimmy, can you unmute yourself if you want to have, like, a counter? But, yeah, start off, yeah, definitely answer the question.
Cool. Before I do, I want to make sure we get at everything Amy's asking. So, Amy, why don't you unmute yourself and ask the question, and if there's anything specific, we'll try to address it.
Hi.
Hey, thanks for your question, by the way.
Yeah, thank you for this amazing webinar today. Just about skipping questions, I just wanted to know sort of your, I guess, thought process in terms of, you know, like you read through the stimulus and When do you know is the right time, or that is a question worthy of being skipped? Because, you know, personally, like, the ego comes in during the exam, and you think you're a badass, and like, and there you are. It's been 5 minutes. So in order to avoid that, what do you think, or what do you recommend is a good strategy in terms of skipping hard questions?
Sure. Yeah. Great question. There's a number of parts to this, and I think you touched on a few of them. Let's start with the basics, and then we'll wean ourselves down to some of the more detailed parts of it. So skipping, just in general, it's a great thing, even if you want to answer, even if you want to answer all the questions. Skipping is really important, and you're right about the whole ego thing. I will tell you, like, so again, I took the LSAT 3 times. The first time, as I was preparing, I remember I was like, huh, I need to be strategic about my skipping. Because here's the thing, even if you answer all of the questions, the issue could be that maybe you're giving yourself too much time on a question.
Right.
Maybe all the questions, but you know, you need to sort of skip it because it's harder and come back to it with fresh eyes. That's a big thing. And psychologically, there's this whole ego thing, right? Because let's say you're taking your PTs and you're scoring. Let's just say you're, like, scoring where you want to score. Let's say you're scoring in the 170s. And you're like, well, I want to get to every question so I can make sure to get my 170+. Even then, I'd encourage you to skip. And here's why. Because even if you want to get to every question, what would really suck is for you to get into that quicksand where you're like, shoot, a minute's gone by. Now 2 minutes have gone by. Now 2.5. Like, you're not going to get that time back. That is really dangerous. And that's time you would not be able to spend on other stuff. And I'm saying stuff that is rather obvious, but we're so cultured to try. We're so cultured to make life. You know, whether you're an American or if you're in another country, like, it doesn't matter. If you're a hardcore test taker, we're cultured to try. And this isn't like the SAT. They penalize you for getting something wrong, but you will run out of time. And so the danger is, right, like, if I spend 3 minutes on a question, well, even if I get it right, there were two, maybe three other questions I could have easily gotten right had I just skipped it. And you're not going to get the time back for those questions. And so you're screwing yourself. You may not get to answer those questions, or you may get to them and you may, like, be under the gun for time because you spent so much time on the other question. So you need to do this. You need to skip. And again, it doesn't necessarily mean that you're not going to answer that question. The way I and I'm spending time on this because we all go through it, and I want to.
Yeah, and this is classic JY's low hanging fruit, or you know, everybody talks about it in the coconuts. Yeah,
the low hanging fruit. David's absolutely right, and the reason, like, the thing is, we could all say why this is important, but then when we're on game day, do we do it? And so I think there's two parts to this. There's sort of like going through the reasons why it's important, which I'm doing now, so forgive me if I'm beating a dead horse. and also putting it in a habit. But just to make sure we get at everything, right? Like, I don't know if this has happened to any of you. Maybe Dave or Amy. Am I pronouncing your name right? Is it Amy or Amy?
It's Ami, actually.
I apologize. I'm sorry.
It's okay. No worries.
Ami, so I don't know if you have had this happen to you, but I've had this happen to me. Where I will be so caught up in a question, and I'll leave it, go answer a few other questions, then come back to it with fresh eyes, and I'll know.
And it helps the second time.
Yeah. Just coming back to a question with fresh eyes, where you're not clouded by, like, I don't, even being in the mental state where you're like, oh man, what am I missing? Why am I not getting it? All these answers seem right. What's going on here? This is tough. Just taking a break from it, doing other stuff, detaching yourself from it can make a world of difference. So I for me personally, to break the whole mental barrier of ego thing and not skipping, what I did was I said to myself, hey, skipping doesn't necessarily mean skipping for good. Skip and come back. And look, if I run out of time and don't get to come back, it doesn't matter. I did myself a favor by cutting bait. But generally, I would say to myself, I'm going to skip and come back to it with fresh eyes.
So I have two scenarios for you. So let's say there is, you know, question, I don't know, 12 or something, really hard, and it's, you know, you just haven't narrowed down to any, and like all 5 answer choices seem really correct to you. At that point, would you completely leave that bubble blank on your answer sheet, or would you guess at random? You know, put a little mark beside it and come back, or would you just leave it completely blank?
Great point about how much time have you spent on this thing? Like a minute?
Well, you've read through the stimulus twice.
Yeah.
And it still doesn't make sense. And then that's just proof that you need to skip it. But how, you know, what do you go about doing it? Do you just completely leave it blank on your answer choice or on your answer sheet?
Yeah, good question. It depends on your strategy. I mean, for me, I would definitely skip it at that point.
Mm-hmm.
If I'm narrowing between, if I'm between two answer choices, I might just mark off one of those to be safe because you can always come back and erase it.
Right.
There, if you want to be safe because you don't know you're going to run out of time, let's say you're between, say, B and D.
Right, and that was my second scenario. You know, you have two or three answer choices left. At that point, you know, you're really feeling B and D, and would you, you know, at that point, would you just randomly, I guess, pick D, you know, and come back to it if time remains?
Yeah, I would pick one of them, and then what I would also do is on my answer sheet, and I could be wrong about this, but I'm pretty certain about this. I would circle the number, right? So if it's question, question 12, I would circle and put a dash next to question 12 because they can't penalize you for that. They get even if somehow it messes with your Scantron, you get a photocopy of it, so you could always contest it. But there's nothing wrong with you putting a dash next to 12, so you know, to come back and recheck between B and D.
Okay, gotcha.
So that's what I would do. I would pick one and go back because you never know. You might run out of time in that 5 minutes. I'm pretty good about the 5 minute thing, so
yeah.
I think it's safe to put something down. If you don't, if you have no idea, the other thing you could do is have like a letter of the day. letter of the day isn't good. There's if anyone wants, I'll try to find it. PowerScore. I'm sorry to mention a different company. I think JY is humble enough to be okay about it. But PowerScore did an interesting thing where they picked the average. I think it was like they were able to find like the most popular correct answer choices statistically for like the first 20 R's and then the last five. So you can memorize those, and then like if the most popular one for the first 20 logical ones is B. I don't know. I'm just guessing, or D or something. Then so if you're not sure of, just put that in there so you have something safe and mark it off so you can come back to it. I'll try to see if I can find that. I think I have it listed somewhere if anybody wants that. Sam, I think you just opined. You said they have a chart on their site with those numbers. So yeah, if anyone wants to go take a look, I'll see if I can find it and send it to everyone. I think you guys have my information. Feel free to PM me if you want it, so that way if I forget.
I also have one last question. It is still about skipping, but it's about RC this time. In terms of skipping in the reading comp section, let's say you're done with the passage, you know, and I guess 7 is giving you trouble. Do you answer that 7 before moving on to the second passage, or you know, finish the entire section of 26 questions and then come back to the 7th question?
Great question. Again, I don't want to say like a whole like, hey, always do this, but I think generally say I would skip and move on to that passage. Here's why.
Right.
Because it would really, really suck if you spent too much time on that one question.
One question.
That passage. So that's why I think it's so worth it to like just get that done. And,
right. It is just one point in the end too. You know, I mean, if you miss it, big deal.
Yes or something and mark it on your sheet so you can come back to it, fine. But here's why it's especially important on reading comp. Because on reading comp, it's not like you can just go to the questions or read a stimulus real quick or whatever. You need to get that passage read before you can even attempt
it. Right, and that's just more time sink.
Yeah, if that cuts into your if that makes it longer before you get to get to that reading passage, that's cutting into the bone, so to speak. I don't know if any of you guys know the phrase.
I mean, I've definitely experienced that, you know, so that's why I'm asking you in terms of how you do it, because it's funny because on LR I'm good with skipping, but on RC somehow this ego comes up, and I'm bad at skipping on RC, which is really ironic, but I'm trying to, you know, I guess balance out the skipping strategy on both sections or across the entire test.
Well, we'll say, I mean, like, one of the things you want to do is, like, again, it's okay, and I'm glad, I think you're right to be smart about it, and to own up to where you're having some trouble and talk about it, because it makes such a difference. And so, like, one, like, rationalize it. Remind yourself of the reasons you need to, right?
Especially
if I've given you enough reasons. Like, if you think about reading comp, that's going to delay your start time on the next passage. And if
exactly.
on the next passage, then you might get flustered as you're doing that passage. Then that might interfere mm-hmm. with your understanding of that passage. And then that might mess with your ability to answer those questions. So really, we want to, I hate to bring up Tony Robbins, I don't know if you guys are fans, but he has this phrase about how, like, you know, people learn pleasure. You want to, like, give yourself enough reasons of pain that will cause you if you don't skip. And think about all the reasons you need to skip. And mm-hmm. but that is, like, honestly, though, that's a big thing. You don't, and think about it. It could have a snowball effect with that one question if you're spending too much time on it.
Mm-hmm.
Then you delay how long you get to the next passage. Then you get flustered on that passage. You don't spend enough time. Then you're, like, running out of time and you don't give those next questions their due. It like, honestly, and I would say this for everyone, for skipping, whether it's on any part of it, like, the more time you spend on this, the more time you spend on one of these, the more of a disastrous snowball effect it can have for the rest of your part, rest of that mm-hmm. section.
Very true.
Yeah, I have, like, my own little metaphors that I've been told. I think it works really great. It's when you're working through the test to have a light rather than a heavy footprint. You don't want to clog into a question. Mm-hmm. You want to think about, you know, okay, this is, like, and if it's just not gelling, either for RC or LR, you circle it and you move on. I mean, I want to move on to another person just because we're running real late. And Mitzi had a question.
Mitzi's question. I want to add one thing because skipping is so important. Mitzi has a question. We're going to get to it. But two things because this is really important. I'm telling you, this is someone who scored above 170. Skipping is important. Like David said, go back and watch JY's video on the low hanging fruit because that's a good way to think about it. The other thing is picture yourself. There are I'll get these in quick. Picture yourself like on one of those game shows where you've got to catch as much money as you can in a short amount of time, because that's basically it. Get all the easy questions first, because you want to grab those dollar bills. You don't want to, like, be jumping to get a high dollar bill if you've only got so much time to grab money on one of those game shows, if that helps. Last thing, remember that this whole order of difficulty, especially on LR, is not a pure, like, upward slope. It zigzags a little bit. Like, yeah, the order of difficulty increases, but they throw some hard ones in. Like, if you're doing, like, there's this general rule people have. Let me just say this one thing. It's really important. There is this general rule that people have of, like, hey, like, maybe I want to do the first 15 LR questions in 15 minutes, or try to. And then I've got 20 minutes on average for my next 10, on average. Fair enough. Here's the problem with that. Question 13 could be crazy hard, because it's not like it's just on this general slope. They could throw in crazy hard questions in there. So what I say is go for a net of 15 in 15 minutes. Make that your goal. Now, you're probably not – maybe you won't get to 15 in 15 minutes, but instead of just going 1 through 15 in 15, I say do a net of 15. That means, like, maybe I'll do questions 1, 2, 3, and 4 is crazy hard. So I'm going to skip 4. Then I'll do question 5, 6, 7, 8. Oh, 8's crazy hard. I'm going to skip 8. Then I'm going to do question, you know, go straight through 12's crazy hard, skip 12. So then by the time I'm done, I'm up to, say, question 18. But out of that 18, it's straight 18, but I have a net of 15 done in 15 minutes. Then I can go back and catch those hard ones that they threw in to throw you off. That's the one way I think of doing 15 effectively in 15 minutes. Like, and it requires skipping because they – I think that'll make you more effective. That's one tip that I would recommend. So anyway, I'm sorry. Without further ado, I have found that to be, like, one of those really effective things that made a difference for me, and I hope it will for you. One other thing, to do this, to properly skip, I promise you we'll get to the next question on negation. To properly skip, what you want to do is make sure you bubble in groups. I think most of you are. But, like, bubbling in groups allows you to properly skip, because if you just bubble one by one, it's going to take up more time, and two, you might end up overlapping by mistake, where if you skip B, you skip, say, 7, then all of a sudden you might put answer 8 in for 7, and that's why bubble in groups, that way you could be like A, B, skip, C, D, or something like that. I think that helps for skipping, if that makes any sense. So I'm done with skipping. I just want to make sure we got all that. So I think Mitzi had a question on negation, so let me open. I hope I haven't missed. Oh, is she here? She might have left.
Hi, I'm here. Can you hear me?
You're here. Okay, cool. So I'm sorry to keep you waiting so long. What's your question on negation?
No worries. Just quickly,
I just want to make sure that you, okay, how do I phrase this? If we just go back to the answer choices for C, I think they were, someone typed them out in the chat. Like, I'm looking at C and D right now. When you're negating, do you only negate the second part, or do you negate the first part too? Because I noticed at one point you negated the second part, but I'm wondering, I think you have to negate both parts. So, for instance, if I'm negating C, I would say, provided that one exercises the muscles on opposite sides of the spine unequally, one will have a generally unhealthy back. Or do I negate, provided that one exercises the muscles on opposite sides of the spine equally, one will have a generally unhealthy back?
Okay, that's fair. The thing is,
because I noticed, like, on the harder NA questions, the way that they type out the answers for, I mean, the sentences for each answer choice will be really convoluted, and it's hard to break it down. So if I'm negating it, do I just negate the last part or all of it?
So while Jimmy's thinking of an answer, I'm going to throw what JY throws at you. sorry, Lizzie. That was really funny. So when it's just a simple sentence, you just negate the verb when it's grammatically. But when we have like these conditionals, like if we have an if X, then Y, a real negation is some X and not Y. Does that make sense? So you don't negate both. You actually negate the necessary condition. And you don't actually make it, you make it sort of a sum statement. So I'm just going to throw that in there while and let Jimmy finish with what he wants to say.
No, I like that. I think that, I tend to approach these a little more intuitively, but I think I've kind of like adapted what JY said without thinking about it at this point. So that kind of breaks it down. So why don't we apply that here? If we're negating the necessary part, right, Dave? So what would that part be? The provided that? Would you agree? Dave, are you there?
Oh, sorry.
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought Dave was. But I think what Dave said is spot on. So we want to negate. So what's the necessary part of this?
Well, if I'm just looking at the, I guess that's the thing. Like, I don't really see that.
Okay. So
in choice C, I guess like the way I attack it is just doing it intuitively and not breaking it down the way Jay does it. Because when I think of that, I think of like diagramming, and I don't know. I feel like for a lot of these, I just don't have time to do that. So when I'm just thinking about it, like, I guess then I'm only negating the last part of answer choice C for question 17.
Yeah. I mean, if I think about C intuitively, if I'm just thinking about C intuitively, right? I mean, let's try both sides real quick and see which one works, if we really think about it. Provided that one exercises the muscles on opposite sides of the back equally, one will have a generally healthy back. So if I do that, I'm going to have a generally healthy back. If I equally exercise both sides, I'm going to have a generally healthy back. But practically, making that untrue, maybe I could exercise both sides and not have a healthy back. That would certainly, I would think that would certainly be a negation of it. Like, hey, I did this. It's not working. Now let's try the opposite. Let's do the other side. Provided that, let's say I don't do it equally. If I don't do it equally, I generally have a healthy back. Is that the opposite? I don't know if that's the opposite. Provided that if I do it unequally, say I, again, just exercise my left side, one will have a healthy back. I mean,
You only have to negate the second part, because if you negate, I mean, if you say unequally and then say unhealthy back, that's just the contrapositive of that statement. So it's the same thing, right?
Yeah. Yeah, like if you, well, yeah, right? So, are you saying, So we don't want to negate both sides and then flip it, because that would be the counterpositive.
But I'm just saying, like, when I'm looking at answer choice C, I would in my, if I'm negating, right, and I'm saying it in my head, I would say, provided that one exercises the muscles on opposite sides of the spine equally, one will have a generally unhealthy back. Correct?
Yeah.
So I wouldn't say, provided that one exercises the muscles on opposite sides of the spine unequally, one will have a generally unhealthy back. Because if I do that, then that would just be the contrapositive of that statement, correct? Or is that not right?
I don't know. So, I mean, you're saying if we just negate the first part and not the second part? Is that what you're saying?
I'm saying that we should just negate the second part.
We should just negate the second part. I don't know if negating the first part, the whole thing you were saying about the contrapositive, I'm not sure if what you said qualifies as a contrapositive. Because remember, the contrapositive is turning is reversing it and then negating both sides. And, I mean, maybe it does, and I'm not seeing how that happens. So I can't say for certain what you said about the contrapositive, but I will.
Okay. Maybe that's not right. But just going back, so then generally with these, you would just negate the second part, right?
Yeah, or negate the necessary, right? Because they're saying, hey, if you do this, if you do X, you're going to get Y. Right, so the opposite would be, if I do X, I don't get Y, right? So they're saying, you know, muscles on opposite sides equally. So I'm doing that. I'm going to get a healthy back. Now it's like, hey, well, I'm doing the equal thing, but I'm not getting a healthy back. That would be the opposite.
Got it. Okay.
That makes sense?
Yeah, it does.
Cool.
Thank you.
No, my pleasure. Any other questions? And it could be on anything. If I can't guarantee I'll know everything, I'm prepared for necessary assumption step. But any other questions, particularly on logical reasoning? I think if there's anything that you've been struggling with that you think might be helpful, let me know. All right. I'm looking. I don't see any hands. Unless if I see anything. Oh, Seema, you have a hand? Seema, you have a question? All right. I think this might be our last question because I have to run myself. Okay, so Seema, let me see if I can open. Seema, can you turn on your mic?
Hi, can you hear me?
I can hear you.
Okay, perfect. So this is not about necessary assumption because I haven't gotten that far in the curriculum. I was prepping for the December test and I realized I was rushing through the curriculum, so I decided to postpone to June. So my question is, I'm doing most strongly supported question types right now, and I've been seeing in the forums a lot of people are saying that there's a big discrepancy between, like, an answer choice being too strong, which is would be the answer choice for most strongly supported versus a must be true question. Could you talk about that for?
So in another course, I've often heard. So Seema, are you familiar with must be true questions?
Yeah, I did that last time, but I'm still on the most strongly supported type now.
No. I'm asking you that for this purpose. The reason I asked that is because in another course I had taken. I'm a big Stubborn Sage fan, but I thought their description of most strongly supported was pretty helpful. They would say they would call it most strongly supported. They would call it soft must be true. Soft must be true. Why do you think they call it soft must be true?
Because it doesn't have to be completely true. It's just the most strongly supported answer choice.
Yeah. It is. I just think it's important to sort of lay the foundation of your question to sort of get at this concept. So the nature of these are such that, you know, it's almost like good to think of it as, yeah, it's kind of like must be true, but it's not, like you said, it doesn't have to be as strong. It doesn't have to be as airtight. There's some leeway there, right? Like, mm-hmm. Most is not the same as all. Most is not the same as every. Probably is not the same as for certain, right?
Mm-hmm.
So that's the nature of these. And so a lot of times, right, for your answer choices, the correct answer choices are generally things that are a little softer as a result. They don't have to be 100%. They don't have to fit airtight. That's why you might have seen something like that. Well, go ahead. I want to make sure. I think that's what I was getting at your question, but would you mind just restating your question so I make sure I answer it perfectly or accurately?
Yeah, yeah, you did. I just sometimes when I'm doing a question, because I'm doing I have the Cambridge 1 through 38 for the LR types, and sometimes like when I'm going through my questions, I get really confused because I think two answer choices could be correct, but I'm not sure, and then I match it against the stimulus and go based on that. I think also some of it's my economics background isn't very strong, and some of it requires no understanding the whole laws of supply and demand and all of that, so I think that could be a factor too, but I was just wondering if you have any advice on how to address that issue.
Okay, yeah, so a couple things. One, I think it's fair to say that you don't sweat the whole like background economics. I loved economics, but I only took it in high school. And then after that, I didn't take it in college because I thought, shoot, I can't compete with these guys. And there is some economics stuff, but it doesn't even matter. The point is, ideally, you shouldn't need a background in any of this stuff. And sometimes I think we can almost be our own worst enemy by where we're like, oh man, these science passages, I don't have a background in science. I don't have a background in economics. Like, let that. You almost want to get to the point where you strip away the players or the content, and it's just focusing on the logic involved. So there's that. Although I could see how that might, you know, throw you off, but that's one part of it. But yeah, I really think it comes down to just acknowledging that the answer doesn't have to be airtight. And just seeing something that kind of fits, seeing something that where it doesn't make it 100% certain, but close, you know, like it makes it probable, makes it likely. Without an example, there's not really much else I can get into, but I think it's a good. You definitely want to be wary of answer choices that are too absolute, if that makes any sense. It worked better for must be true questions. You want softer answer choices.
Okay. That actually helps me out a lot, so thank you.
Okay, cool. Cool. Yeah, I remember myself going crazy one time on it. I was like, oh man, this doesn't fit. And I realized, wait a minute, it's a most strongly supported question. It doesn't have to be airtight. So yeah. And then the other thing, one other thing, I think JY is a great thing when you're struggling between two answer choices. He said one time, he said, look, they don't do you any favors. They're going to make the correct answer choice. They're going to make it written in an awkward way often, or it won't be as like fresh and clear. It might be a little unclear, right? Whereas the attractive choices have attractive words that could throw you off and be very tempting. So you almost want to, and the good thing he said, listen, the attractive choices can be attractive but flawed. It could be flawed by like one answer, one word in the answer choice. So my way when I'm between two answer choices, and you can apply this for other questions as well as most strongly supported, what I often do is if I'm between two answer choices, I say, okay, well, one of these might be correct, and it might not be written in the most user-friendly way. Fine. The other might be attractive but flawed, right? There has to be a flaw if it's not the answer choice. So what I'll do is if I'm between two answer choices, I'll look for the flaw. I'll look at both of them, and I'll see if there's a flaw in one of them that makes me eliminate it. So maybe there's one word. Maybe it can come down to one word like not, and I don't see it because I'm rushing. So that could also be helpful to you.
Okay. Sorry.
And that's going to have to be the last word for this. But I want to actually, the last word is going to be when I unmute everybody. I'd like to give Jimmy a huge hand for doing an awesome, awesome workshop on necessary assumptions. I'm unmuting you all. Please, let's all give Jimmy a big hand for that. Am I the only one? That's kind of sad. Oh, yeah, good, good, good. I get good.
Thank you guys very much. It was a pleasure. I hope I didn't go on too long. I hope I didn't screw up or anything. But you can, you know, I'm Quicksilver on Seven Sage, so if you have any questions, feel free to PM me. I also tutor, so if you want to ask about that, I'd be happy to. But yeah, if you generally have any questions or need any tips, feel free to PM me.
Yeah, and, please. He's a great tutor. If you want to add this, he's got, as you can see, he's a wealth of information. So please utilize him, PM him a quick silver. He looks like Napoleon Dynamite. But I want to thank everybody, especially Jimmy, for attending. And please, I've said this before, we really want to keep doing this, but this GoToMeeting profile is just, it's expensive. We're on the, hold on, Maxie, sorry, buddy. It costs money. We're trying to get Seven Sage to pay for this. Please, if you had a good time, if you thought you learned a lot, please say so in the forums. It'll really help us when we're trying to convince Seven Sage to fund this apparatus, this forum, this way, this platform. So I just want to thank you so much. Have a great rest of your Saturday. And Jimmy, as you can see, has his email right there in the comments. Please take that down. And oh, my pleasure, Jimmy.
And thanks to Dave for organizing this. He's been working with you.
My pleasure. My absolute pleasure. So everyone have a great evening, and we'll see you. Oh, one last thing. All this interaction that we've been having, hopefully you found it very helpful. I thought it was helpful just to see people working and struggling through things. This is exactly what we do during Group BR. So we're going to have our first for the juniors on Wednesday. It is test 29. That's I chose this purposely so that people who were taking in the curriculum, I think, could do this. I think you could take PT 29. Yeah, you maybe don't score it in BR, and you could still participate and still deal with stuff and still have conversations. I think so. I would hope to see you if you want to join us at 39 onwards. It's fine too. But we start this next Wednesday. Not next Wednesday. This coming Wednesday. So hopefully we'll see you there at 8 p.m. Eastern time. Thank you again, Jimmy. Thank you, everybody, for staying so late. Don't forget, if you want private tutoring from Jimmy, give him an email at darkhorselsat@gmail.com or just private message him on the discussion board, Quicksilver. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Dave.
Thank you, Jimmy.
Look at his cheese.